Esther, my dear.
Why, Esther? Fancy seeing you here so early. What brings you all this way from town?
I felt so restless. I felt I had to come out and see Eyolf today. Little Eyolf. And you, Rita. So I called the steamer, and here I am.
And quite by accident, you happened to meet someone you knew? A friend on board?
No, as a matter of fact, I didn't. Why, Rita, what's that?
Alfred's portmanteau. Don't you recognize it?
You mean Alfred's come home?
Yes, would you believe it? He arrived quite unexpectedly by the night train.
So that was it. That was what brought me here. And he hadn't written to say he was coming. Not a postcard.
Not a word.
Not even a telegram.
Yes, it arrived an hour before he did. Short and to the point. Isn't that just like him, Master?
Yes, that's his way. He always was secretive.
Well, it makes it all the more wonderful to have him home again.
I know how you feel.
A whole fortnight before I was expecting him.
And he's well and happy. Not depressed.
He looked quite transformed as he came in through the door.
He must have been tired, surely.
Tired? He was ready to drop, poor darling. He'd come most of the way on foot.
That mountain air must have been too sharp for him.
I don't know. I haven't heard him cough once since he got back.
Well, there you are. The doctor was right, after all, to advise him to go on that walking tour.
Yes, I suppose so, but you don't know what a dreadful time this has been for me, Esther. I haven't been able to bring myself to talk about it, and you've hardly ever been out to see me.
I should have come more often.
But no, no. You had your schoolwork to attend to in town, I know. And our pioneer, our builder of roads, he's been away too, hasn't he?
Oh, stop it, Rita.
Very well. The pioneer is dismissed. Oh, but Asta, how I've missed Alfred. How empty it's been. How desolate. Just as though someone had died here.
Rita, he's only been away 6 or 7 weeks.
Oh, but you must remember that Alfred has never been away from me before. Not even for a day. Not in all the 10 years.
But Rita, that's just why I thought it was time he got away this year. He ought to have gone walking in the mountains every summer. That's what he ought to have done.
Oh, it's easy for you to talk. If I were as sensible as you are, I would have let him go before now, perhaps. But I couldn't, Esther, I couldn't. I felt somehow that if I once let him go, I might never get him back again. You can understand that, can't you?
No. But then I don't have anyone I'm afraid of losing.
Really? No one at all?
Not that I know of. But tell me, Rita, where is Alfred? Asleep?
Asleep? Not he. He got up this morning just as early as ever.
He can't have been all that tired then.
He was when he arrived last night. But now he's been in with Eyolf for, at least an hour.
Poor pale little child. Is he going to be made to study all day again?
Well, you know Alfred wants it that way.
Yes, Rita, but I think you ought to try and stop him.
Well, really, I can't be expected to interfere in these things. Alfred is better qualified to understand these matters than I am. What else will you have Eyolf do? He can't run about and play like the other children.
I shall speak to Alfred about it.
Yes, my dear, you do that. Ah, here they are.
Asta! Ha! Asta, my dears! Are you out here? It's good to see you. So soon.
I felt I had to. Welcome home.
Thank you.
Doesn't he look splendid?
Wonderful. Wonderful. Your eyes so sparkly. You must have done a lot of writing while you've been away. Have you finished the book?
The book? Oh, that.
I thought it would go easily once you could get away and be alone.
Yes, I used to think so too, but it didn't turn out that way. If I must confess the truth, I haven't written a line.
You haven't written?
Oh, so that's why I found all those blank sheets of paper in your bag.
Well, my dear Alfred, what on earth have you been doing all this time?
Walking and thinking, thinking, thinking.
Thinking a little of us too, I hope.
Yes, of course, a lot, every day.
Well then, everything is as it should be.
But did you really do no work at all on the book? You look so happy and contented. We don't often see you like that. I mean, when your work's not going well.
Yes, I know. I've been so stupid. Thinking is what matters. What one can manage to put down on paper is insignificant.
Insignificant?
Have you gone mad, Alfred?
No, Father. What you write is important.
Yes, my son, if you say so, but I tell you, there is one who will come after me who will do these things better.
Who will that be? Oh, tell me.
Give him time. He will show himself.
But what will you do when he comes?
I shall return to the mountains.
Oh, shame on you, Alfred.
To the high peaks and the great wide spaces.
Don't you think I shall soon be well enough to come with you?
Perhaps, perhaps, my boy.
I think it would be nice if I too could climb mountains.
Mm.
How smart you look today, Eyolf.
You think so, Hans?
Yes, Is it for your father's sake you put your new clothes on?
Yes. I asked Mother to let me. I wanted Father to see me in them.
You shouldn't have given him that kind of suit.
But he begged me so again and again. He gave me no peace.
Father, Borkheim has given me a bow. Isn't it wonderful? And he's taught me to shoot with it.
Yeah, that really is a good idea, Eyolf.
Next time he comes, I'm going to ask him to teach me to swim, too.
To swim? Why do you want to learn that?
All the other boys can swim. I'm the only one who can't.
Now, you shall learn anything. Anything you want to learn, you shall.
Shall I tell you what I most want to learn, Father?
Mark, tell me.
Most of all, I should like to be a soldier.
Little Eyolf, there are so many other things better than that.
Yes, but when I grow big, I must be a soldier. You know that.
Yes, we'll see. We'll see.
Eyolf, come over here. I have something to tell you.
What is it, Aunt?
What do you think? I have seen the rat wife.
What? You've seen the rat wife? Oh, no, it isn't true.
Yes, it is. I saw her yesterday.
Where did you see her?
On the road outside the town.
I saw her, too, out in the countryside.
Perhaps we shall see her, too, then, Eyolf.
Aunt, isn't it strange that she should be called the rat wife?
People call her that because she goes round the country and drives away all the rats.
I believe her real name is Mother Lupus.
Lupus. That means wolf, doesn't it?
Oh, what a lot of things you know, Eyolf.
Then perhaps it may be true after all that she turns into a werewolf at night. Do you think it is, Father?
No, I don't think so. Now, why don't you run out and play in the garden?
Oughtn't I to take some of my books with me?
No, no more books from now on. Go on, run down to the shore and play with the other boys.
No, Father. I don't want to play with them today.
Why not?
Because of my clothes.
Do they make fun of your fine clothes?
No, they wouldn't dare do that. If they did, I should beat them.
Well, then why?
I don't like them, Father. And they say I can never become a soldier.
Why did they say that?
I think they envy me. They're so poor, Father. They have to go barefoot.
Ah, Rita, how this gnaws at my heart.
Now, now, now.
Those boys shall know one day who is master down there.
Someone's knocking.
Must be Borkheim.
Come in.
Aunt, this must be her.
Begging your pardon? Have your honours any troublesome thing that gnaws here in this house?
Have we? No, I don't think so.
Ah. I'd be glad to rid you of it if you had any gnawing thing that troubles you.
We understand, but we have nothing like that in this house.
That's a great pity. For I'm on my rounds, and who knows when I shall pass this way again. Oh, but I'm tired.
Yes. Yes, indeed. You look tired.
Poor little creatures. Everybody hates them. After them the whole time. It oughtn't to be tiring helping them, being kind to them, but it drains the body's strength.
Sit and rest yourself, old woman.
Thanks, gracious lady. A thousand thanks. The whole night I've been about my business.
Have you? Where?
Over on the islands. The people there sent for me. They didn't want to, but they had no choice. They had to bury their teeth in the sour apple. Sour apple, little master. Sour apple.
Why did they have to?
Have to what, little master?
Bury their teeth in the sour apple.
Why? Because they couldn't find anything to fill their bellies with. Because of the rats and all the hungry little baby rats. You understand, young master?
Poor wretched people, were they so plagued by them?
Plagued, thousands of them, swarming, teeming. Up in the beds they crept and crawled the whole night long. They plopped down into the milk churns. Over the floor they hissed and rustled this way, that way.
I never want to go there, Aunt.
But then I came. I and another. And we took them all away with us, the sweet small creatures. We made an end of every one of them.
Father, look, look!
For God's sake, Eyolf, what's the matter?
Something's struggling in the bag!
Oh! get rid of her after. Oh,
dear lady, don't be afraid of such a harmless little creature.
What have you got there?
It's only Mopsy Man. Come up from your darkness, my little Mopsy Man. Don't be afraid of him, my little wounded soldier. Come close and stroke him. He won't bite you. Come and stroke him. Come and stroke him. Come and stroke him.
No, I don't.
Doesn't the young master think Mopsy Man has a lovely, gentle face?
Him?
Yes, dearie, him.
I think it's the most horrible face I've ever seen.
Well, you'll change your mind. You'll change your mind.
And at the same time, he's beautiful. Beautiful.
But just now, he's so tired and full of aches and pains, poor little creature. It drains a body's strength, that game.
What game?
Why, follow my leader.
Oh, so this, is this dog of yours the one who lures and leads them?
Mopsamand and I, we lead them. We work together, he and I. Easiest thing in the world, you think, to watch us. I tie a string to his collar, and then I lead him 3 times round the house. While I do this, I play on my pipe. And when they hear me play, up they have to come from the cellars, down from the lofts, out of all the dark holes and crannies. All of them. Bless their little hearts.
Then he bites them all to death?
No. We just go down to the boat, he and I. And they come after us. All the old ones and their little darlings with them.
And then what happens?
Well, we draw away from the land. I pull at the oars and then I play on my pipe. And Mopsy Man swims behind. And all the little creatures that crept and crawled, they follow us further and further out to the deep waters. They have to.
Why do they have to?
Because they don't want to. Because they're so afraid of the deep water. That's why they have to swim out to it.
And then they drown?
Every single one. Men. They have all the dark and peace and quiet they could wish for, the little angels. They sleep so long, so sweet a sleep. All the little creatures that men hate and persecute. In the old days, I needed no Mopsy Man. I could lure them myself, alone.
What did you lure?
Men. One especially.
Who? Oh, tell me.
Why, my sweetheart. Little ladies' man.
Where is he now?
Down among the rats. Now, I must be about my business again. Are you sure you have no work for me to do? I could get it done at once.
No. No, thank you. I don't think we need your services today.
You don't think so? But you can never be sure. If you should remember anything that nibbles and gnaws, creeps and crawls, just send for me and Mopsy Man. Fare ye well.
And now I've seen the rat wife too.
Is this your portfolio, Master?
Yes. It's got some of those old letters in it.
Oh, the family letters.
Don't you remember? You asked me to go through them while you were away.
Did you really manage to find the time?
Yes, I did some of it here and some at home in town.
Thank you. Did you find anything of interest in them?
One always finds something of interest in old letters. The ones in the portfolio are my mother's.
Yes, well, you must keep them, of course.
No, Alfred, I'd like you to look through them too, sometime later. I haven't brought the key of the portfolio with me today.
Yes, well, never mind, my dear. I shan't want to read your mother's letters.
One quiet evening, I will tell you something they contain.
Yes, I'll do that, but you keep your mother's letters. You haven't so many reminders of her.
Oh, that horrible old woman. She's brought the smell of death into the house.
Yes, yeah, she was rather horrible, wasn't she?
She felt quite ill while she was in the room.
You know, I can understand that power of compelling and drawing things that she spoke of. Being alone in the mountains up on those huge open spaces, one feels that power.
What's happened to you, Alfred?
Happened?
Yes, something's happened. You've changed. Rita knows it too.
Yes, I knew at once. But that's good, isn't it, Alfred?
Well, I hope so. Something good must come from it.
Something happened to you while you were away. Don't deny it. I can see it.
Well, nothing happened to me, but...
What?
In me something happened, a kind of transformation.
Oh, God.
Only for the better, Rita, dear. Believe me.
Now, you must tell us all about it. Absolutely everything.
Yes. Well, let's sit down. And I'll try to tell you as well as I can.
Well?
When I look back on my life, the road I have taken these past 10 years, it seems almost like a fairy tale or a dream. Don't you think so, Asta?
Yes, I think so in many ways.
When I think what we were, Asta, two orphans without a penny.
Oh, that was so long ago.
Now I sit here comfortable, prosperous, able to follow my calling, to work and study just as I please. And all this unbelievable, unlooked-for happiness we owe to you, my dearest Rita.
Now, that's enough of that silly talk.
Yes, well, I mentioned this only as a kind of preamble.
Well, let's take it as read.
Rita, don't think it was the doctor's advice that drove me up to the mountains.
Not the doctor.
What was it, then?
I couldn't find peace to write anymore.
No peace? But, my dear, who disturbed you?
Oh, no one disturbed me. I just came to feel that I was really misusing my... neglecting my true gifts. That I was wasting time.
You're writing?
Well, don't you see, I wasn't put here just to write. There must be something I can do as well.
And that was what you were brooding over?
Yes, mostly.
So that's why you've been so discontented with yourself these last months and with us too. Oh, yes, you were, Alfred.
I sat there, bent over my desk, writing day after day, nights as well, writing and writing my... great thick book on the responsibility of man.
But, my dear, that book is your life's work.
Yes, you've told us so often enough.
It was going to be, or so I thought, from the time I grew up, and then you made it possible for me to devote myself to it, my dearest Rita.
What nonsense you talk.
You with your gold and your green forest.
Oh, if you go on talking like that, I shall smack you.
But the book, Alfred.
Somehow it began to seem less and less important, and the claim of higher duties began to fill my mind.
Alfred.
I'm thinking of Eyolf, my dear.
Oh, Eyolf.
He's always in my mind since that tragic fall from the table, and especially now that we know he can never be cured.
But you do everything you can for him, Alfred.
As a schoolmaster, perhaps, but not as a father. From now on, I want to be a father to Eyolf.
I don't think I quite understand you.
I mean, I want to do everything in my power to help him to come to terms with the irrevocable and live with it.
But, Alfred, thank God, I don't think Eyolf feels so deeply about it.
Yes, Rita, he does.
Yes, my dear, you may be sure he feels it deeply.
But, Alfred, what more can you do for him?
I want to try to reveal the potential of the dreams which are dawning in his childish mind and to nurture those high hopes so that they flower and come to fruition. And I want to do more than that. I want to help him to shape his ambitions towards goals that lie within his reach. Because as he is now, he longs only for the things he can never attain. And I want to put happiness within his grasp.
Shouldn't you take these things more calmly, Alfred?
Eyolf shall take up my life's work, if he so wishes. Or perhaps he may choose to attempt something which shall be completely and entirely his. Perhaps that would be best. In any case, I shall write no more.
But, Alfred, dearest, couldn't you work both for yourself and for Eyolf?
No, impossible. In this matter, I cannot divide myself. Therefore, I prefer to yield. Eyolf shall be the one of our family to fulfill himself, and it shall be my task to bring him to self-fulfillment.
But,
has been a hard struggle for you, Alfred, to come to this decision.
It has. You see, here at home, I could never hope to conquer myself. I've never been able to force myself to renounce anything, not in this house.
Was that why you went away this summer?
Yes! I climbed up into an infinite solitude. I saw the sun rise above the mountaintops, and I felt nearer to the stars, almost as if I understood them and belonged with them. And then I was able to do it.
But will you never carry on with the responsibility of man?
No, never. I've told you, I cannot divide myself between two tasks. I shall fulfill my ideal of human responsibility through my own life.
Do you really believe you'll be able to stay faithful to such high ideals in this house?
With your help, Rita, and with yours, Asta.
And you can divide yourself after all.
My dearest Rita.
Good morning, Mrs. Holmes. Well, what's this? Home again already, Mr. Holmes?
I came back last night.
His leave was up, Mr. Borgheim.
She's joking.
Joking? It's the truth. His leave had expired.
You keep your husband on a tight rein, Mrs. Holmes.
I insist on my rights. In any case, everything has to come to an end sometime.
Oh, not everything, I hope. Good morning, Miss Holmes.
Good morning.
Not everything, did you say?
I do believe there is at least one thing in this world which need not come to an end.
I see. You're thinking of love and that kind of thing.
I'm thinking of all that is lovely and unforgettable.
And that will never end. Yes, let's hope so for all our sakes.
You will soon have finished this road you've been building up here.
I have finished it. Yesterday. It's taken a long time. Thank heavens that came to an end.
And that's why you're so cock-a-hoop this morning.
Yes.
Well, I must say.
What, Mrs. Holmes?
That's not very nice of you, Mr. Borgheim.
Why not?
Well, it means you won't be seeing very much more of us.
No, that's true. I hadn't thought of that.
Still, I suppose you'll be able to visit us now and then.
No, no, that won't be possible for a long time. I've just been given an important new contract, which I have to start work on at once.
Have you? I'm delighted to hear it.
Congratulations, Mr. Borgheim. Congratulations.
I'm not meant to be talking about it yet, but I can't keep it to myself. It's a big road that's to be built up in the north. There's mountains to negotiate and extraordinary obstacles to overcome. It's a marvelous life to build new roads.
And is it just this new road that brings you here in such high spirits?
No, not only that. The whole future seems so full of hope and promise.
Perhaps there's something even more marvelous lying ahead.
Well, who knows? When fortune comes, she comes like the spring floods. Miss Holmes, shall we two take a little stroll together as usual?
No. No, thank you. Not now. Not today.
Please, just for a few minutes. There are so many things I want to say to you before I go.
Something else you mustn't talk about yet, perhaps?
I.
Well, things that cannot be talked about may sometimes be whispered, though we be master.
But Rita.
Miss Astor, remember this will be our last walk together.
Well, let us take a short stroll in the garden, then.
Thank you. Thank you.
You might keep an eye on Eyolf while you're down there.
Eyolf, why? Yes, where is Eyolf today? I brought something for him.
He's playing down there, Summer.
Really? So he's started to play now. He usually just sits indoors, reading.
I'm going to change all that now. I want him to spend a lot of time out of doors.
Quite right. Let him have his share of the free air, too, poor little fellow. Good God, the best thing we can do in this blessed world is to play. I sometimes think our whole life is a game. Come, Zaza.
Rita, do you think there's anything between those two?
I don't know what to think.
I used to believe there was, but Asta's been behaving so strangely these last weeks. Almost as though she'd become a stranger to me.
Well, while I've been away, you mean?
Yes, these last weeks.
You don't think she's really interested in him?
Not seriously. Not with her heart and soul. Ruthlessly. No, I don't think she's seriously interested in him now. Would it upset you if she was?
Not upset me, exactly. I can't deny that it would worry me a little, though.
Worry you?
But remember, I'm responsible for Asta and for her happiness.
Nonsense. Responsible. Asta isn't a child. She's old enough to know whom to choose for herself, I should have thought.
Let us hope she is, Rita.
I see no harm in Borgheim.
No, my dear, neither do I. Rather the reverse.
And I should be very happy to see him and Asta married.
Would you? Why?
Because she'd have to go far away with him. And then she could never come and visit us again.
Do you mean you want to be rid of Asta?
Yes, Alfred. Yes.
Why?
Yes. Because then I would have you to myself at last. No, not even then. Not to myself. Oh, Alfred, Alfred, I can't let you go.
Please, my dear, be reasonable.
No, I don't want to be reasonable. I only want you, nothing else in all the world. You.
Now let go of me, you're strangling me.
Oh, I wish I could. Oh, when you knew how I've hated you.
Hated me?
Yes, when you sat alone in there, brooding over your work deep into the night. So long, Alfred, and so late. Oh, how I've hated that work of yours.
Well, now I've finished with it.
Yes. And now you're preoccupied with something even more hateful.
Hateful? You call our child hateful?
I do. For what he's done to us. Your book had no face, no voice, but this child is a living wall between us. I won't stand for it, Alfred. I tell you, I won't stand for it.
Sometimes you almost frighten me, Rita.
Sometimes I frighten myself. Don't rouse this demon in me, Alfred.
In heaven's name, do I do that?
Yes. When you destroy what is most sacred between us.
Rita, be reasonable. It's your child, our only child we're talking about.
The child is only half mine, but you... You shall be mine. All mine. Only mine. I demand it. It's my right.
My dear Rita, it's no use demanding. These things can only be given freely.
And from now on, you are unable to do that.
Yes, from now on, I must divide myself between Eyolf and you.
But if Eyolf had never been born?
Well, that would have been different. Then I would have had only you to love.
And I wish to God I'd never born him.
Rita, you don't know what you're saying.
I gave birth to him in unimaginable pain, but I enjoyed it gladly for your sake.
Yes, I know you did.
But that's over and done with. I want to live with you. Just you and I. I can't be just a mother, Eyolf's mother, and nothing else. I cannot, I tell you, I will not. I want to be everything to you. To you, Alfred.
But you are, Rita, through our child.
Oh, sickening, stale phrases. That's not for me. I was made to bear your child, but not to act the mother to it. You must take me as I am, Alfred.
You were always so fond of
him. I pitied him, because you gave him no love or kindness. Made him read until his eyes ached. Hardly spent an hour with him.
Yes, I was blind. I had not yet come to realize
that. But now you have.
Yes, at last. Now I see that the highest duty open to me in this world is to be a true father to Eyolf.
And to me? What are you going to be to me?
I shall go on loving you, Rita, with all my soul.
I'm not interested in your soul. I want you, all of you, to myself. The way it used to be in those first few unforgettable years. I will never let myself be fobbed off with scraps of love.
But surely there is enough happiness to share between the three of us.
And you can't want much.
Oh.
Listen.
What was it?
When I got your telegram last night.
Yes.
I dressed in white.
Yes, I noticed you were wearing white when I arrived.
I let down my hair.
Yes, it smells so sweetly.
So that it streamed down over my back and shoulders.
I know, Rita. You were so beautiful.
I put rose-colored shades over both laps. We were quite alone, just you and I, awake in the whole house. And there was champagne on the table.
I didn't have any.
True, you didn't. The champagne stood there. But who raised his glass? As the poet said.
I was full of serious thoughts. I was determined to speak to you about our future, and above all, about Eyolf.
And so you did.
No, I wasn't able to. You started to undress yourself.
Yes. And while I undressed myself, you talked to me about Eyolf. Remember, you asked me how little Eyolf's stomach was?
Rita.
And then you lay down in your bed and slept like a child.
Rita.
Alfred.
Yes.
The champagne stood there. But who raised his glass?
I left it untouched. God.
But let me tell you something, Alfred.
What?
Don't be too sure of yourself.
Sure of myself?
You take things too much for granted. You're too sure that you have me.
I don't know what you mean.
I've never been unfaithful to you, Alfred, even in my thoughts, not for a moment.
I know, Rita. I know you so well.
But if you should ever turn your back on me...
Turn my back on you? I don't understand what you mean.
You don't know what I might do if...
If?
If I should ever really believe that you no longer cared for me. Loved me as you used to do.
My dearest Rita, people change with the years. It must happen to us also. It does to everyone.
Not to me. And I won't have any change in you either. I couldn't stand it. I want to keep you all to myself.
Your jealousy is terrible.
I can't change. I am what I am. If you should divide yourself between me and anyone else...
Well, what?
I would have my revenge on you, Alfred.
How would you have your revenge on me?
I don't know. Yes, I do know.
How?
I would throw myself into the arms of the first man who came along.
Ah, that you could never do, my proud, faithful Rita.
Oh, you don't know what I might do if you ever stopped loving me.
If I stopped loving you, how can you say such a thing?
I could, for example, spread my nets for that builder of roads who was walking in our garden.
Thank heavens, I thought for a moment you were being serious.
So I am. Why not him as well as the next man?
Well, besides, he's already...
So much the better if I took him from someone else. That's exactly what Eyolf has done to me.
Now, how can you say that Eyolf has done that?
You see. As soon as you even mention Eyolf's name, your voice becomes soft and trembles. I'm almost tempted to wish that... Oh, well.
Well, what would you wish, Rita?
No. No. No, I won't tell you ever.
Rita, I beg you, for both our sakes, do not let yourself be tempted to anything that is evil.
Well, Miss Almers and I have taken our last walk together.
You won't be taking a longer journey?
I shall, yes.
Alone?
Yes, alone.
You hear that, Alfred? I wouldn't mind betting some evil eye has played you a trick here.
Evil eye?
Yes.
You believe in the evil eye, Mrs. Almers?
I'm beginning to. Or anyway, the evil that lies in a child's eye.
How can you?
It is you who are making me like this, Alfred.
What's that noise?
What is it? Those gutter snipes up to something again, I suppose?
Hey, you boys! What's going on down there?
What are they saying?
They say a child's been drowned.
Oh.
A child drowned?
A little boy, they say.
They can all swim, can't they?
Where's Eyolf?
Don't worry, he's playing in the garden.
No, he wasn't when we were there.
Whose child is it, did you say?
It isn't Eyolf. It isn't Eyolf.
Shh, be quiet, let me hear what they're saying.
They say.
They say. The Gratch is floating.
No. No.
Eyolf. Oh, God. They must save him.
They must. They must. It's so precious a life. So precious a life.
You oughtn't to sit here in this grey weather, Alfred. I've been looking for you for such a long time.
Thank you.
Have you been sitting here long? The whole time?
No. I don't understand it. It seems so impossible, all this. Has it really happened, Asta? What am I dreaming? Have I gone mad? Oh, if only it were a dream. How beautiful if I could wake up now.
Wish I had the power to wake you.
How merciless the fjord looks today. Lying there so heavy, drowsy,
lead grey with flashes of yellow reflecting the rain clouds.
Alfred, you mustn't sit here staring at the fjord.
On the surface, yes, but deep down, there is the undertow.
For God's sake, don't think of that.
Oh, you think he lies out here, don't you, Asta? But he doesn't. You needn't fear that. Remember how strong the current is here. It's out to the open sea.
God.
That is why little Eyolf has been taken so far. Far away from us now.
Don't talk like that, Alfred.
You can work it out. You're so clever with figures. 28 hours. No, 29 hours. Let me see.
Alfred!
Can you see the meaning of it?
Of what?
Of what has been done to me and Rita.
The meaning of it?
Yes, the meaning. There must be some meaning in it. Life, creation, providence. Have they no meaning, no purpose at all?
Oh, Alfred, how can we tell the purpose of these things?
No, indeed. Perhaps it is all haphazard. And things take their own course, like a wrecked ship, drifting. Perhaps that's how it is. It seems so, anyway.
What if it only seems?
Oh, perhaps you can give me a better answer. As for my part, I see none. Here was Eyolf standing on the threshold of discovering life, potent with promise, such rich promise. He was to fill my life with pride and joy, and then it only needs a crazy old hag to come to the house and dangle a dog in a sack.
But Alfred, we don't know for certain how it happened.
Oh, yes, we know. The boys saw her row out over the fjord, and they saw Eyolf standing alone on the end of the jetty, staring after her. And suddenly he seemed to become giddy, and then he fell and disappeared.
I know.
She dragged him down into the deep, I'm sure of it.
My dear, why should she?
Exactly, why should she? It can't be retribution. There is nothing to atone for. Eyolf never did her any harm, never shouted abuse at her, never threw a stone at a dog. He'd never set eyes on her or the dog before yesterday. So, it can't be retribution. How meaningless it is. How absolutely meaningless, Asta. And yet, it seems to serve the purposes of Providence.
Have you talked about this with Rita?
No, I seem to find it easier to talk to you about it than about everything else. What's that you have there?
Only some crepe.
Yeah. Is it necessary?
Rita asked me to do it. May I?
By all means. Where is Rita?
Out in the garden, I believe. Borgheim is with her.
Is Borgheim out here today?
Yes, he came by the noon train.
I didn't expect him to take the trouble.
He was very fond of Eyolf.
Borgheim is good and loyal.
Yes. You're right, he is loyal.
You're fond of him, aren't you?
Yes, I'm fond of him.
Yet you can't quite make up your mind to...
Oh, Alfred, let's talk about it.
Very well. Can you tell me why?
No, please. Don't ask me. It's too distressing for me to talk about. Here. Your hat's ready.
Thank you.
Now, give me your left arm.
Do you want to put crepe on that too?
It's usual.
As you wish.
Keep your arm still, otherwise I shall prick you.
This is like old times.
Yes, isn't it?
You used to sit like this mending my clothes when you were a little girl.
I wasn't very good at it.
I remember the first thing you ever sewed for me was a piece of black crepe.
Oh?
Yes, on my student cap when Father died.
Really? I didn't remember.
No, of course not. You were only a child then.
Yes.
Then 2 years later when your mother died, you sewed a big black band on my arm.
I thought you ought to have one.
Yes, quite right. And then afterwards, when we two were left alone in the world, you finished already?
Yes. Turned out to be a happy time for us after all, Alfred. Just the two of us.
Yes, it did. It was a hard struggle, though.
It was for you.
It was a struggle for you too, Master. Dear faithful Eyolf.
Never mind me of that nonsense.
If you'd been a boy, you would have been called Eyolf.
If? Yes. But then when you went to the university, to think you could have been so childish.
I was childish?
Yes. Now I look back on it. You were ashamed of not having any brother, only a sister.
No, it was you who were ashamed.
Perhaps a little. I felt, I don't know, somehow sorry for you.
You must have done. You got out all the old clothes I'd worn as a boy.
Your best Sunday clothes. Do you remember that blue blouse and the knee breeches?
How well I remember how you looked when you put them on and walked round in them.
I only did it when we were alone at home together.
How solemn we were and how seriously we took ourselves. And I would always call you Eyolf.
Alfred, you haven't said anything about this to Rita, have you?
Yes, I believe I mentioned it to her once, yes.
Alfred, how could you?
Well, you know how it is. One tells one's wife everything, practically everything.
I suppose one does.
But how can I sit here and...
What is it?
I almost forgot him. I forgot him completely.
Eyolf?
Yes, I was sitting here, absorbed in my memories, and he wasn't there.
No, Alfred, you're wrong. Little Eyolf was there in everything we said.
He was not. He slipped right out of my mind, out of my thoughts. I didn't see him for a moment while we were talking. All that while, I forgot him completely.
You must have some rest from your grief.
No, that's something I cannot have. I have no right to it, and I have no heart for it either. There is no place for me but the place where he lies, drifting down there in the dark.
Alfred. Alfred, don't go near the field.
Don't go to him. Let go of me, Asta. Please, let me get to the boat.
No, Alfred. No, don't go near the field.
No. No, I won't. Please, just leave me alone.
You must let your mind rest. Come and sit down with me again.
Very well. As you wish, Esther.
No, not there.
Yes, let me sit here.
No, when you sit there, you look over... Like that. No. That's better, isn't it?
Hmm.
Now let's go on with what we were talking about before.
Yes. It was good to forget these sorrows for a moment.
You must forget, Alfred.
But don't you think me weak and unfeeling to be able to do so?
No. One cannot circle round the same thought forever.
Well, I can't anyway. Before you came down to me just now, I was sitting here, tormented by this haunting, gnawing grief, and can you believe it, Asta?
What?
In my agony, I suddenly found myself wondering what there was going to be for dinner today.
As long as it gave you some comfort.
Comfort, yes. That is what I seem to find. What a blessing I have you, Asta. It gives me such joy, joy in my sorrow.
Your greatest joy should be Rita.
Yes, of course, but Rita is not of my blood. It's not the same as having a sister.
Is that how you feel, Alfred?
Hmm? Yes, well, our family is something apart. Our Christian names always began with a vowel, and do you remember how we used to talk about it? And all our relations are equally poor, and we all have the same eyes.
But
and,
I...
Ah, Asta, you are not... You are your mother's child. Don't really look like one of us, not even like father. And yet...
Yet?
I was thinking that our life together has somehow made you and me resemble each other. Mentally, I mean.
No, Alfred, you're wrong. Hmm? It's I who've grown to resemble you.
Oh.
I owe everything to you, everything I value in the whole world.
You owe me nothing, Asta. On the contrary.
Yes, Alfred, I owe everything to you. You should know that. No sacrifice has been too great.
Sacrifice? What nonsense you talk, Asta. I have simply loved you ever since you were a small child. And besides, I always felt there was so much I had to make amends for. Not so much for what I had done as for father.
Father? What do you mean?
Well, father was never very kind to you.
You mustn't say that.
But it's true, he never loved you as he should have done.
Perhaps not as much as he loved you, but that was only to be expected.
No, he's often unkind to your mother, too, during their last years together.
You must remember, Mother was so very much younger than he.
Hmm. Do you think they weren't suited to each other?
I think perhaps not.
And yet Father was always so kind and generous to everyone else.
Mother was not always as she should have been.
Your mother?
Perhaps not always.
To Father?
Yes.
I never noticed anything.
Oh, Alfred, let the dead rest in peace.
Yes, let them rest. But the dead will not give us peace. Day and night they haunt us.
It will seem less painful as time goes by.
It must, mustn't it? Though how I shall survive these first ghastly days, I cannot imagine.
Go up to Rita.
Now, don't ask me to do that. I can't. Don't you understand? I can't. Let me just... Let me stay here with you.
All right. I won't leave you.
Thank you. Where is my little Eyolf now? Can you answer me that, my big, wise Eyolf? No. No one in the whole world can tell me that. I know only the one dreadful certainty, that I no longer have him.
They're coming now.
Hmm? How are you, Rita?
Need you ask?
Why have you come down here?
Only to look for you. What are you doing?
Nothing. Asta came down to sit with me.
Yes, but what were you doing before Asta came? You've been away from me the whole morning.
I've been sitting here, looking out over the water.
How can you?
I prefer to be alone now.
Sitting in the same spot like a statue.
Well, I have no reason to go anywhere.
I can't bear it anywhere, least of all here with the fjord lapping one's feet.
Well, that's why I sit here, because it is so near the fjord.
Don't you think he should come up with the rest of us?
I think it would be better for you if you...
No, leave me where I am.
In that case, I shall stay with you.
As you please. Asta, you stay too.
Let us leave them alone together.
Miss Holmes, shall we stroll along the shore together for the very last time?
Yes. Let us.
Is it possible that we have lost Eyolf?
We must accustom ourselves to that thought.
I can't. I can't. That dreadful sight. I shall never forget it as long as I live.
Sight? What sight? What have you seen?
I didn't see it myself, only heard about it.
Well, tell me.
I went with Borgheim down to the jetty.
Why did you go there?
I wanted to question the boys about how it happened.
Well, we know.
We know more now.
What?
It isn't true that he disappeared at once.
They say that now?
They say they saw him lying on the bottom, deep down in the clear water.
They didn't save him?
Don't suppose there's anything they could do.
They can all swim, can't they?
They say he lay on his back with his eyes wide open.
With his eyes open?
Yes.
And quite still?
Yeah, quite still. And then something came and carried him out towards the sea. They called it the undertow.
That was the last they saw of him?
Yeah.
No one will ever see him again.
Day and night, I shall see him lying there.
With his eyes wide open.
With those huge, open eyes. I can see them. I can see them now.
Were they evil eyes, Rita?
Evil?
Were they evil eyes staring up from the seabed?
Alfred!
Answer me, were the child's eyes evil?
Alfred!
Now it is as you were, Streeter.
I
What did I wish?
That Eyolf should be out of the way.
Never for a moment did I wish that. I wish that he might not stand between us, yes, but...
Well, he won't. Now will he?
Perhaps now more than ever. Oh, the dreadful sight.
Yes, the evil eye of a child.
Leave me alone now, but you frighten me. I've never seen you like this before.
Well, grief makes one cruel.
Yes, it has made me so, too.
You never loved him, not really.
Eyolf would never allow me to make him wholly mine.
Because you never wanted him.
You're wrong, I did want him. But someone stood between us from the first.
You mean I stood between you?
Oh, no, not in the beginning.
But who then?
His aunt.
Asta?
Yes. Asta stood like a wall between Eyolf and me.
You felt that?
Yes. Asta made him hers. Right from the time it happened. The accident.
Well, if she did it out of love.
Exactly. And I'm not prepared to share with anyone, not in love.
Well, you and I ought to have shared him in love.
If it comes to that, you never loved him either.
I never loved him.
Yeah. You're only ever in love with your book about responsibility.
I was preoccupied with that, it is true, but I gave it up for Eyolf's sake.
But not because you loved him.
What do you mean?
You gave it up because you were eaten up with self-distrust. You'd begun to doubt whether you had any great calling to live for after all.
Did I give you cause to think that?
Oh, yes, in small things. And then you needed something new. I dare say I wasn't enough for you any longer.
It is the law of change, Rita.
That was why you wanted to make poor little Eyolf into a child prodigy.
That's not true. I wanted him to be happy, that's all.
But not because you loved him. Look into yourself. And think of all you have buried there. And would like to forget.
You're trying to avoid the issue.
So are you.
Well, if you're right in what you're thinking, our child never really belonged to us.
No. We never loved him.
And yet we sit here bitterly mourning his loss.
Yes. Isn't it odd that we are sitting here mourning a little stranger boy?
Rita, for God's sake, don't call him a stranger.
We never won his love, Alfred, neither you nor I.
And now it is too late. It's too late. And it is you who are guilty. Yes, you. It's your fault that he became what he was. It's your fault that he couldn't save himself when he fell into the water.
Alfred, don't blame me for that.
I do, and you know it's true. Because it was you who left that helpless baby unattended on the table.
He lay there so comfortably among the cushions and slept so sweetly, and you promised to keep an eye on him.
That's right, and then you came and tempted me into you.
Oh, be a man and admit that you forgot the child and everything.
By God, you're right. I forgot the child in your arms.
Alfred, that's vile.
In that moment, you condemned little Eyolf to death.
You too. If I am guilty, so are you.
Oh, very well, we are both guilty. So, there was retribution in Eyolf's death, after all.
Retribution?
Yes, a judgment on you and me. And now we have what we deserve. Because while he lived, our cowardly, furtive consciences would not let us love him because we could not bear to look at the thing he carried.
The crutch.
Yes, that. And what we call our loss, our grief, is merely the gnawing of our consciences, nothing more.
Alfred, this can only lead us into despair, perhaps beyond into madness. We can never undo what has been done.
I dreamed of Eyolf last night. I thought I saw him coming up from the jetty. He could run like the other boys. Nothing had happened to him, nothing at all. This stifling existence was only a dream, I thought. Oh, Rita, how I praised and thanked.
Whom?
Whom?
Whom did you praise and thank?
I told you I was dreaming.
The one in whom you do not believe.
It just happened that way. I was asleep, I tell you.
You should not have sowed the seeds of doubt in me, Alfred.
Would I have done better to let you continue through life believing in empty illusions?
It would have been better for me. I should at least have been able to turn somewhere for comfort. Now I'm nowhere.
Right, if you were given the choice now, if you could follow Eyolf to where he now is.
Yes.
If you could be sure you would find him again, know him, understand him.
Yes. Yes.
Would you leap the gulf to join him? Leave all this. Renounce life. Would you do that, Rita?
You mean now?
Yes, today. Now, answer me, would you?
I don't know. I think I shall choose to stay here with you for a while.
For my sake?
Yes, only for your sake.
But afterwards, would you? Answer me.
What can I say? You know I could never leave you. Never.
Suppose I were to go to join Eyolf, and suppose you knew for sure that you would find both him and me there? Then, would you come to join us?
I should like to. With all my heart.
But?
I don't think I could. No. No, I simply couldn't. No, not even for the promise of heaven.
Neither could I.
No, you couldn't do it either, could you, Alfred?
No. Because this is where we belong. Here, on Earth. Living.
Here is the kind of happiness we understand.
Oh, happiness. Happiness.
You mean we shall never find happiness again? But suppose... No, I don't say it.
Say it, Rita, say it.
Couldn't we try to... If only we could forget.
Forget Eyolf?
No, forget ourselves, our guilt.
Is that what you want?
Yes, if it's possible. I can't stand this much longer, Alfred. Can't we find something to make us forget?
What?
We could travel, go far away.
Go away? You're never happy anywhere but here.
Well, we could invite people here. Keep open house. Throw ourselves into some activity which would deaden...
That kind of life is not for me. No, rather than that, I would try to take up my work again.
Your book, which has stood for so many years between us.
There will always be something between us now.
Why?
Who knows if huge child eyes don't watch us night and day?
Alfred.
Our love has been a consuming fire. Now it has burned itself out.
Burned out?
It is already burned out in one of us.
And you dare say that to me?
It's dead, Rita. But something has taken its place. A sharing of guilt and remorse, a sharing in which perhaps there is a new beginning, a resurrection.
Resurrection? What do I care for resurrection?
Rita.
I'm flesh and blood. I cannot drowse my life away like a fish. To be walled up for the rest of my life in a cell of guilt and remorse with a man who is no longer mine, mine, mine!
It had to end sometime.
Had it to end like this? A love that began as consumingly as ours did.
My first feeling for you was not love, Rita.
What was it, then?
Fear.
That I can understand. But if that was so, how did I manage to win you?
You were so... so consumingly beautiful, Rita.
Was it only that, Alfred? Answer me, was there nothing else?
Yes. There was something else.
I can guess what it was. My gold and my green forests, I think you called them. Aren't I right, Alfred?
Yes.
How could you? How could you do it?
I had Aster to think of.
Ah, yes. Aster. So it was Aster who brought us together.
She knows nothing. She has no inkling of it even now.
Nonetheless, it was Aster. No. It was little Eyolf. Yes, Alfred. Little Eyolf.
Eyolf?
You used to call her your little Eyolf, didn't you? I seem to remember your telling me once, in a secret moment. Do you remember that terrifyingly beautiful moment, Alfred?
I remember nothing. I don't want to remember.
It was the moment when your other little Eyolf became a cripple.
The retribution.
Yes. The retribution. Well, Aster, have you and Mr. Borgheim said all you had to say to each other?
Yes, I think so.
Miss Almus has been very quiet during our walk.
Really?
Alfred and I have said enough to each other.
Yes?
To last us for the rest of our lives. Come now, let us go up to the house. Alfred and I need company from now on. We two can't be alone now.
You two go ahead, Asta. I must have a word with you.
Indeed. Well, come with me then, Mr. Borgheim.
You mean with Rita?
Yes, Rita and I cannot go on living together.
Alfred, you mustn't say such dreadful things.
It's true. Living together makes us evil and cruel.
I'd never realized.
Nor had I until today.
And now you want... Yes, what do you want, Alfred?
To get away from this place! Far away from it all!
And live on your own?
Yes, as I used to.
Alfred, you can't live alone.
Well, I did once.
You mean in the old days, but then you had me with you.
Yes, and I want to come home to you again, Asta.
To me? No, Alfred, that's quite impossible.
Because of Borgheim?
No, you're wrong. It's not because of him.
Well, I'm glad then I return to you, my dear. Dearest, just I must come home to you to be cleansed and purified from my life for
Alfred,
this.
It's the same.
Now I have sinned against her, but not in this. Remember, Asta, don't you remember how our life used to be? Was it not one long ecstasy of dedication?
Yes, but you can't relive the past.
Well, you mean my marriage has unfitted me to that kind of life?
No, I don't mean
then let
that.
Us live again as we used to.
No, Alfred, we cannot.
We can! Love between brother and sister is the one relationship which does not obey the law of change.
But if that should turn out not to be our relationship.
Not what you mean?
My mother's letters. The ones in the portfolio.
Well, what about them?
Read them when I've gone.
Why?
Well, you'll find that...
Well, what?
That I have no right to bear your father's name.
Asta?
Read them. Then you'll see. And understand. And perhaps be able to forgive. My mother, too.
I don't understand. I can't credit it. Asta, you mean you...
You are not my brother, Alfred.
Well, what difference does that make? None at all.
It changes everything. Our relationship is no longer that of brother and sister.
It's still sacred. It will always remain sacred.
Now it must obey the law of change.
What do you mean?
Don't say... Oh, dearest. Oh, do you see these water lilies?
Yes, they're the sort that shoot up to the surface from the deep.
I gathered them from the lake where it flows into the field. Would you like them?
Thank you.
Take them as a last greeting from little Eyolf.
From Eyolf out there or from you?
From us both. Come, let us go up to the house.
Ah, here you are.
I thought I would sit here and look out over the fjord for the last time.
How lucky for me I came here too.
Have you been searching for me?
Yes. I wanted to get the chance to say au revoir. Not goodbye, I hope.
You are very persistent.
You have to be a road builder.
Did you see anything of Alfred or Rita?
Yes, all and both.
Together?
No, apart.
What are you going to do with that flag?
Mrs. Almers asked me to come and hoist it.
Hoist it? Now?
Yes, to half mast. Let it hang there night and day, she said.
Poor Rita. Poor Alfred.
Have you really the heart to leave them? I ask because I see you're dressed for a journey.
I have to go.
Yes, of course, if you must.
You're going tonight too?
Yes, I too must go. I shall be catching the train. Will you be on it?
No, I'm taking the steamer.
Ah, different ways then.
Yes.
Miss Astor, you can't imagine how deeply little Eyolf's death grieves me.
I know it does.
It hurts so much. You see, it's not in my nature to mourn.
Time will heal it, as it heals all things, all sorrows.
All? Do you believe that?
They pass like summer showers. When you're far away from here, then...
It will have to be very far.
And you have your big new road to think about.
Yes. With no one to help me with it.
Of course you will.
Oh, no one to share the excitement and the joy of the work and... That's what one wants to share.
What about the sweat and the toil?
Oh, that one can endure alone.
But the joy must be shared.
Yes. What's the use of finding happiness if one cannot share it with anyone?
Perhaps you're right.
Of course one can enjoy happiness alone for a while, but not for long. No, happiness can only be felt by two.
Two? Why not three? Or five? Or ten?
So that's a different kind of happiness. But, Miss Astor... Couldn't you bring yourself to share the joys and triumphs of life and the sweat and toil, too, with just one person?
I have tried it once.
Have you?
Yes, all the years my brother, all the years Alfred and I lived together.
Oh, your brother. Well, that's quite different, surely. I'd call that peace rather than happiness.
Anyway, it was wonderful.
Well, there now, even that seemed wonderful. But suppose, now just suppose he had not been your brother.
Then we would not have lived together. I was a child at the time, and he was little more than a child.
Were they so wonderful, those years?
Yes. Oh, yes, they were.
You had moments of real happiness and exhilaration?
Yes. So many. So many.
Tell me about them, Miss Astor.
Oh, there were only little things.
Such as?
Such as the time Alfred won his scholarship to the university. He'd done so well. And when he got a poster to school, or when he was working at his thesis and read it to me, and then later it got printed in a periodical.
Yes, I can imagine it. Must have been a good life. Brother and sister, sharing each other's happiness. I don't know how your brother ever brought himself to let you go.
He got married, you know.
Yes, that must have been difficult for you.
Yes, at first. I thought I'd lost him.
But luckily you hadn't.
No.
All the same, how could he... Marry, I mean. When he could have gone on living with you.
Law of change, I suppose.
Law of change?
It's Alfred's phrase.
It's a stupid law. I don't believe in it.
Perhaps not now. You may come to believe in it in time.
I never. But listen to me, Miss Astor. Be sensible about all this.
Please! Please, Mr. Borgham, let's discuss it any further.
Miss Astor, I can't let you go as easily as that. Your brother has chosen his own way of life. He's quite happy without you. He doesn't even miss you. Then this thing happened which altered everything for you.
What do you mean?
The death of his child. What did you think I meant?
Well, little Eyolf. Yes.
now there's nothing to keep you here any longer. No little crippled child who needs your love, no duties, nothing.
Mr. Borkheim, please, don't make it so hard for me.
I must. I would be mad if I did not. Any day now I shall leave town. I may not have an opportunity to see you there before I go. I may not see you again for years. Who knows what may happen before we meet again?
So you are afraid of the law of change?
Oh, no, I'm not. In any case, what changes have I to be afraid of? In you, I mean. It's clear you don't really care for me.
You know I do.
Not enough. Not in the way I want you to. In God's name, Aster. Miss Aster, can't you see how wrong you're being? Just over the horizon, a whole lifetime of happiness may be lying in wait for us. And we're simply letting it lie there. Don't you think we're going to regret it, Aster?
I don't know. I only know we have to let it lie there, waiting.
Well, then I must build my roads alone.
Oh, if only I could share it with you. The joy and the work.
Would you if you could?
Yes, I would.
But you can't.
Would you be content with only half of me?
No, I must have all of you.
I cannot.
Then goodbye, Miss Aster.
Is Rita down there, in the summer house?
No, there's no one here but Miss Aster.
Shall I go down and look for her and get her to come up here?
No, don't bother. Did you hoist the flag?
Yes. Yes, your wife asked me to. That's why I came up here.
You'll be leaving us tonight?
Yes, tonight I really am leaving you.
You have found a good traveling companion, I trust.
I shall be traveling alone.
Alone?
Yes, alone.
Really?
And I shall stay alone.
It's terrible to be alone. The thought of it chills my blood.
But you're not alone, Alfred.
That can be terrible too, Asda.
Don't talk like that.
If you're not going with, why not stay out here with me and Rita?
No, Alfred, I can't. I must go back to town now.
Come to town, Asda. Are you here?
Yes.
I promise you will come out here again soon.
No, I can't promise that. Not for a while.
As you wish. We shall meet in town then.
But Alfred, you must stay here with Rita now.
I think you're probably lucky to be traveling alone.
What on earth do you mean?
You never know whom you may meet on the journey. The right traveling companion when it is too late.
Alfred.
What do you mean? I don't understand.
Why are you all leaving me?
You said you wanted to be alone.
I know, but I don't. It's getting so dark, I seem to see huge open eyes staring at me.
What if they are, Rita? You shouldn't be afraid of those eyes.
I don't know how you can say that to me.
Aster, I beg you, please. Stay here with Rita.
Yes. And with Alfred, too. Please stay, Aster.
I would. So gladly.
Well, then stay. Alfred and I cannot face our grief alone, our bereavement.
Why not say the gnawing of our consciences?
Whatever you call it. We two can't face it alone. Aster, I beg you with all my heart, please, stay here and help us. Be to us what Eyolf was.
Eyolf?
You'd like her to stay, wouldn't you, Alfred?
If she can and if she wants to.
You used to call her your little Eyolf, didn't you? From now on, you shall be our Eyolf, Aster. Eyolf, as you used to be.
Stay, share our life, Aster, with Rita, with me, your brother.
No, we can't. When does the steamer leave?
Any minute now.
Then I must go aboard. Are you coming with me?
Am I? Yes. Yes, yes.
Come on, then.
Oh, I see. Well, in that case...
Thank you, Rita. For everything. Goodbye, Alfred. Goodbye.
What is this, Aster? A
Are you running away?
Yes, I am.
From me?
From you. And from myself.
Here's the steamer, Rita. Come and look.
I dare not look at it.
Dare not?
No. It has a red eye and a green eye also. Great, glaring eyes.
No, they're only lanterns.
They'll always be eyes to me. They stare and stare out of the darkness. And into the darkness, too.
Now she's coming alongside.
Where will they be mooring her this evening?
At the jetty, as usual, my dear.
How can they moor her there?
You know they have to.
But it was there that Eyolf... How can they do it?
Life is pitiless, Rita.
People are pitiless. They don't consider anyone, neither the living nor the dead.
You're right. Life goes on just as if nothing had happened.
Nothing has happened to the rest of the world. Only to you and me.
Rita, how meaningless it was, your pain in burying him. For now he is gone, without a trace.
Only the crutch was saved.
Be quiet, I never want to hear that word.
I can't bear the thought that he's gone from us.
You managed well enough while he was alive. Whole days would pass without your seeing him.
Only because I knew I could see him any time I wanted.
Yes. That was how we wasted the few years we had with the little Eyolf.
Listen, Alfred, it's tolling again.
It's the steamer sounding its bell. It's ready to leave.
No, I don't mean that bell all day. This bell's been ringing in my ears. Ah, there it is again.
You're mistaken, Rita.
No. I hear it so clearly. Sounds like a funeral bell. Slowly. Slowly. Always the same words.
Words? What words?
The crutch is floating. The crutch is floating. Can't you hear it?
I hear nothing. There's nothing to hear.
You can say what you like. I hear it clearly.
Now they're aboard, Rita. Now the ship is steaming towards the town.
Surely you can hear it. The crutch is floating. The crutch.
You mustn't sit there listening to something that isn't there. I tell you, Asta and Borg, I'm aboard now and on their way. Asta has gone.
You will soon be gone too then, Alfred.
What do you mean?
You will be following your sister.
Has Asta said anything to you?
No. But you told me yourself it was for Asta's sake that you married me.
Yes, but you have bound me to you by the years we have lived together.
Ah. In your eyes, I am not so... so consumingly beautiful as I was once.
Perhaps the law of change will hold us together, in spite of everything.
The change is taking place in me. God, it hurts me so.
Hurts?
Like a birth.
That's what it is. A birth. Or a resurrection, a transition to a new way of living.
But it means the wreck of all life's happiness.
In that wreck lies our victory.
Oh. Words. Good God, we are human, flesh and blood.
We're also kin with Sea and Sky, Rita.
You, perhaps, not I.
You two more than you know.
Alfred, couldn't you think of taking up your work again?
That work you hate so much?
I'm humbler now. I'm ready to share you with your book.
Why?
Only to keep you here. Near me.
I can be of little help to you, Rita.
But perhaps I could help you.
To work, you mean?
No. To live.
I have no life left to live.
To endure the years that remain, then.
I think it would be best for both of us if we were to part.
Whom would you go to? Asta?
No, not Asta. She'll never see her again.
Where then?
Up into my solitude.
The mountains?
Yes.
These are only daydreams, Alfred. You couldn't live up there.
Perhaps, but that is where I long to go.
Why?
I want to tell you something.
Something that happened to you up there?
Yes.
Something you kept from Asta and me?
Yes.
Why do you always keep everything to yourself? You shouldn't.
I will tell you.
Yes. Tell me.
I was alone up there, in the heart of the high mountains. And suddenly I came to a large, desolate lake. And I had to cross that lake, but I couldn't. For there was no one there. And no boat.
And then what happened?
I went all alone, with no one to guide me, into a side valley. I felt that way I could push forward over the heights and between the peaks and so come down on the other side of the lake.
And you got lost?
Yes. So I lost all sense of direction. For there was no kind of road, nor path there. I walked all day, and all night too. I began to think I would never find my way back.
I know your thoughts were with us.
No, they were not. It was strange. Both you and Eyolf had drifted far, far away from me. And Asta too.
Then what were you thinking about?
Nothing. I struggled along the deep crevasses, exulting in the peace and serenity of being in the presence of death.
Oh, it's horrible. How can you use such words about it?
That was how I felt. I had no fear. I felt that death and I walked side by side like two good fellow travelers. It all seemed so natural, so logical. In my family, we do not live to be old.
Don't talk about it anymore, Alfred. You were alive.
Yeah. Suddenly, I found I was there on the other side of the lake.
Must have been a night of terror for you, Alfred, but now that it's over, you won't admit it.
That night resolved me. I turned back and came home to Eyolf.
Too late.
Yes. For my fellow traveler came and claimed him. And then suddenly he seemed loathsome and life too. This damned existence that we dare not tear ourselves away from. We are earthbound, Rita. You and I.
Yes. You're the same, aren't you? Oh, let us live our lives together. As long as we can.
Live what for? Our lives are empty wastes, whichever way I look.
Oh, Alfred, sooner or later you will leave me. I feel it. I can see it in your eyes. You will leave me.
You mean when my fellow traveler comes for me?
No, worse. Of your own free will. Because it is only when you are here, with me, that your life is meaningless. Answer me, Alfred. Isn't that what you think?
And if I do?
What's that? Oh, they found him.
He will never be found.
Then why are they shouting?
They're only fighting As usual.
Down by the shore.
Yeah. The whole of that damned village ought to be cleared. Now the men have come home. Drunk, of course. Someone is beating his children. Listen to them, yelling. And his wife shouting for someone to save them.
Oughtn't we to get someone to go down and help them?
Help them? They were the ones who let Eyolf drown. No. Let them perish as they let Eyolf perish.
You mustn't talk like this, Alfred, or even think it.
How else can I think? All those old shacks ought to be demolished.
And what would happen to those poor people?
They'd have to find somewhere else.
And the children?
Does it matter where they lead their miserable lives?
You're making yourself hard, Alfred.
I have a right to be hard. A duty.
A duty?
Yes, my duty towards Eyolf must not lie unavenged. So there it is, Rita. I advise you to think it over. Have that village leveled to the ground when I am gone.
When you are gone.
At least it will give you something to occupy yourself with. You will need that.
You're right. I shall need something. But can you guess what I'm going to do when you are gone?
Bart, tell me.
The moment you leave me, I shall go down there and bring all those poor, neglected children up to this house.
What do you want them up here for?
I want to make them mine.
You?
Yes. The day you leave me, they shall all come and live up here as if they were mine.
In our Eyolf's place?
Yes. They live in Eyolf's room, look at his books, play with his toys.
This is absolute madness. There is no one in the whole world less suited than you to such work.
Then I shall have to teach myself. Work and learn.
If you really mean this, Rita, a great change must indeed have taken place in you.
It has, Alfred. You've seen to that. You left me empty. And I must try to fill that emptiness with something. Something resembling love.
It's true. We never did much to help those poor people, did we?
We didn't do anything.
Hardly thought of them.
Not with compassion, anyway.
We who had the gold and the green forests.
We closed our doors to them and our hearts, too.
No wonder they wouldn't risk their lives to save little Eyolf.
Ask yourself, Alfred. Are you sure? Quite sure. We would have risked ours.
Rita, can you doubt it?
We're so earthbound, Alfred. You and I.
Well, what do you intend to do for these wretched children?
To begin with, I shall try to make life less hard for them.
If you can do that, Eyolf will not have been born in vain.
And will not have been taken from us in vain.
Don't deceive yourself, Rita. You're not doing this out of love.
No, I'm not. Not yet, anyway.
Why are you doing it, then?
I've so often heard you talking to Astor about human responsibility.
That book you hated so much.
I hate it still, but I sat there and listened to you talking. And now I want to carry on from there. In my own way.
For the sake of that unfinished book?
No. I have another reason. I want to placate the eyes that stare at me.
Rita, will you let me stay with you?
Would you like to?
Yes, if I was sure I could help you.
You would have to go on living here.
Well, let's see if we cannot make it work.
Yes, Alfred. Let us see.
have a long day ahead of us, Rita.
You will see a Sunday calm will fall on us. Now and then.
Then perhaps we shall sense their spirits beside us.
Spirits?
Yes. Perhaps they will visit us. The ones we have lost.
Our little Eyolf. And your big Eyolf, too.
Perhaps now and then, on our way, we shall catch a glimpse of them.
Where shall we look, Alfred?
Upwards?
Yes. Upwards.
Up towards the mountains? Towards the stars? And the great silence? They're the sort that shoot up to the surface from the deep.
I gathered them from the lake where it flows into the fjord. Would you like some?
Thank you.
Take them as a last greeting from little Eyolf.
From Eyolf, aren't they, or from you?
Both. Come, let us go up to the house.
Ah, here you are.
I thought I would sit here and look out over the fjord for the last time.
How lucky for me I came here too.
Have you been searching for me?
Yes. I wanted to get the chance to say au revoir. Not goodbye, I hope.
You are very persistent.
You have to be a road builder.
Did you see anything of Alfred or Rita?
Yes, saw them both.
Together?
No, apart.
What are you going to do with that flag?
Mrs. Armour's asked me to come and hoist it.
Hoist it? Now?
Yes, to half mast. Let it hang there night and day, she said.
Poor Rita. Poor Alfred.
Have you really the heart to leave them? I ask because I see you're dressed for a journey.
I have to go.
Yes, of course, if you must.
You're going tonight too?
Yes, I too must go. I shall be catching the train. Will you be on it?
No, I'm taking the steamer.
Ah, different ways then.
Yes.
Miss Astor, you can't imagine how deeply little Eyolf's death grieves me.
I know it does.
It hurts so much. You see, it's not in my nature to mourn.
Time will heal it, as it heals all things, all sorrows.
All? Do you believe that?
They pass like summer showers. When you're far away from here, then...
It will have to be very far.
And you have your big new road to think about.
Yes. With no one to help me with it.
Of course you will.
Oh, no one to share the excitement and the joy of the work and... That's what one wants to share.
What about the sweat and the toil?
Oh, that one can endure alone.
But the joy must be shared.
Yes. What's the use of finding happiness if one cannot share it with anyone?
Perhaps you're right.
Of course one can enjoy happiness alone for a while, but not for long. No, happiness can only be felt by two.
Two? Why not three? Or five? Or ten?
So that's a different kind of happiness. But, Miss Astor... Couldn't you bring yourself to share the joys and triumphs of life and the sweat and toil, too, with just one person?
I have tried it once.
Have you?
Yes, all the years my brother, all the years Alfred and I lived together.
Oh, your brother. Well, that's quite different, surely. I'd call that peace rather than happiness.
Anyway, it was wonderful.
Well, there now, even that seemed wonderful. But suppose, now just suppose he had not been your brother.
Then we would not have lived together. I was a child at the time, and he was little more than a child.
Were they so wonderful, those years?
Yes. Oh, yes, they were.
You had moments of real happiness and exhilaration?
Yes, so many. So many.
Tell me about them, Miss Astor.
Oh, there were only little things.
Such as?
Such as the time Alfred won his scholarship to the university. He'd done so well. And when he got a post at a school, or when he was working at his thesis and read it to me, and then later it got printed in a periodical.
Yes, I can imagine it. Must have been a good life. Brother and sister sharing each other's happiness. I don't know how your brother ever brought himself to let you go.
He got married, you know.
Yes, that must have been difficult for you.
Yes, at first. I thought I'd lost him.
But luckily you hadn't.
No.
All the same, how could he marry, I mean, when he could have gone on living with you?
Law of change, I suppose.
Law of change?
It's Alfred's phrase.
It's a stupid law. I don't believe in it.
Perhaps not now. You may come to believe in it in time.
I never. But listen to me, Miss Astor, be sensible about all this.
Please! Please, Mr. Borgham, let's discuss it any further.
Yes, Astor, I can't let you go as easily as that. Your brother has chosen his own way of life. He's quite happy without you. He doesn't even miss you. Then this thing happened which altered everything for you.
What do you mean?
The death of his child. What did you think I meant?
Well, little Eyolf. Yes.
Now there's nothing to keep you here any longer. No little crippled child who needs your love. No duties, nothing.
Mr. Borgheim, please don't make it so hard for me.
I must. I would be mad if I did not. Any day now I shall leave town. I may not have an opportunity to see you there before I go. I may not see you again for years. Who knows what may happen before we meet again?
So you are afraid of the law of change?
Oh, no, I'm not. In any case, What changes have I to be afraid of? In you, I mean. It's clear you don't really care for me.
You know I do.
Not enough. Not in the way I want you to. In God's name, Aster. Miss Aster, can't you see how wrong you're being? Just over the horizon, a whole lifetime of happiness may be lying in wait for us. And we're simply letting it lie there. Don't you think we're going to regret it, Aster?
I don't know. I only know we have to let it lie there, waiting.
Then I must build my roads alone.
Oh, if only I could share it with you. The joy and the work.
Would you if you could?
Yes, I would.
But you can't.
Would you be content with only half of me?
No, I must have all of you.
I cannot.
Then goodbye, Miss Aster.
Is Rita down there, in the summer house?
No. No, there's no one here but Miss Aster.
Shall I go down and look for her and get her to come up here?
No, don't bother. Did you hoist the flag?
Yes. Yes, your wife asked me to. That's why I came up here.
And you'll be leaving us tonight?
Yes, tonight I really am leaving you.
You have found a good traveling companion, I trust.
I shall be traveling alone.
Alone?
Yes, alone.
Really?
And I shall stay alone.
It's terrible to be alone. The thought of it chills my blood.
But you're not alone, Alfred.
That can be terrible too, Aster.
Don't talk like that.
If you're not going with, why not stay out here with me and Rita?
No, Alfred, I can't. I must go back to town now.
Come into town, Aster. Are you here?
Yes.
I promise you will come out here again soon.
No, I can't promise that. Not for a while.
As you wish. We shall meet in town, then.
But, Alfred, you must stay here with Rita now.
I think you're probably lucky to be traveling alone.
What on earth do you mean?
You never know whom you may meet on the journey. Alfred. The right traveling companion when it is too late.
Alfred.
What do you mean? I don't understand.
Why are you all leaving me?
You said you wanted to be alone.
I know, but I don't. It's getting so dark, I seem to see huge open eyes staring at me.
What if they are, Rita? You shouldn't be afraid of those eyes.
I don't know how you can say that to me.
Aster, I beg you, please. Stay here with Rita.
Yes. And with Alfred, too. Please stay, Aster.
I would. So gladly.
Well, then stay. Alfred and I cannot face our grief alone, our bereavement.
Why not say the gnawing of our consciences?
Whatever you call it. We two can't face it alone. Aster, I beg you with all my heart, please, stay here and help us. Be to us what Eyolf was.
Eyolf?
You'd like her to stay, wouldn't you, Alfred?
If she can and if she wants to.
You used to call her your little Eyolf, didn't you? From now on, you shall be our Eyolf, Aster. Eyolf, as you used to be.
Stay, share our life, Aster, with Rita, with me, your brother.
No, I can't. When does the steamer leave?
Any minute now.
Then I must go aboard. Are you coming with me?
Am I? Yes. Yes, yes.
Come along then.
Oh, I see. Well, in that case...
Thank you, Rita. For everything. Goodbye, Alfred. Goodbye.
What is this, Aster? Are you running away?
Yes, I am.
From me?
From you. And from myself.
Thank you.
Here's the steamer, Rita. Come and look.
I dare not look at it.
Dare not?
No. It has a red eye and a green eye also. Great, glaring eyes.
You know they're only lanterns.
They'll always be eyes to me. They stare and stare out of the darkness. And into the darkness, too.
Now she's coming alongside.
Where will they be mooring her this evening?
At the jetty, as usual, my dear.
How can they moor her there?
You know they have to.
But it was there that Eyolf... How can they do it?
Life is pitiless, Rita.
People are pitiless. They don't consider anyone, neither the living nor the dead.
You're right. Life goes on just as if nothing had happened.
Nothing has happened to the rest of the world. Only to you and me.
Rita, how meaningless it was, your pain in burying him. For now he is gone, without a trace.
Only the crutch was saved.
Be quiet, I never want to hear that word.
I can't bear the thought that he's gone from us.
You managed well enough while he was alive. Whole days would pass without your seeing him.
Only because I knew I could see him any time I wanted.
Yes. That was how we wasted the few years we had with the little Eyolf.
Listen, Alfred, it's tolling again.
It's the steamer sounding its bell. It's ready to leave.
No, I don't mean that bell all day. This bell's been ringing in my ears. Ah, there it is again.
You're mistaken, Rita.
No. I hear it so clearly. It sounds like a funeral bell. Slowly. Slowly. Always the same words.
Words? What words?
The crutch is floating. The crutch is floating. Can't you hear it?
I hear nothing. There's nothing to hear.
You can say what you like. I hear it clearly.
Now they're aboard, Rita. Now the ship is steaming towards the town.
Surely you can hear it. The crutch is floating. The crutch...
You mustn't sit there listening to something that isn't there. I tell you, Astor and Borgheim are aboard now and on their way. Astor has gone.
You will soon be gone too then, Alfred.
What do you mean?
You will be following your sister.
Has Astor said anything to you?
No. But you told me yourself it was for Astor's sake that you married me.
Yes. But you have bound me to you by the years we have lived together.
Ah. In your eyes, I am not...
Let us.
Alfred, is it possible that we have lost Hill?
We must accustom ourselves to that thought.
I can't. That dreadful sight. I shall never forget it as long as I live.
Sight? What sight? What have you seen?
I didn't see it myself, only heard about it.
Well, tell me.
I went with Borgheim down to the jetty.
Why did you go there?
I wanted to question the boys about how it happened.
Well, we know.
We know more now.
What?
It isn't true that he disappeared at once.
They say that now?
They say they saw him lying on the bottom, deep down in the clear water,
They didn't save him.
Don't suppose there's anything they could do.
They can all swim, can't they?
They say he lay on his back with his eyes wide open.
With his eyes open?
Yes.
And quite still?
Yeah, quite still. And then something came and carried him out towards the sea. They called it the undertow.
That was the last they saw of him?
Yeah.
No one will ever see him again.
Day and night, I shall see him lying there.
With his eyes wide open.
With those huge, open eyes. I can see them. I can see them now.
Were they evil eyes, Rita?
Evil?
Were they evil eyes staring up from the seabed?
Alfred!
Answer me, were the child's eyes evil? Now it is as you wish, Rita.
What did I wish?
That Eyolf should be out of the way.
Never for a moment did I wish that. I wish that he might not stand between us, yes, but...
Well, he won't. Now will he?
Perhaps now more than ever. Oh, the dreadful sight.
Yes, the evil eye of a child.
Leave me alone, Alfred. You frighten me. I've never seen you like this before.
But grief makes one cruel.
Yes, it has made me so, too.
You never loved him, not really.
Eyolf would never allow me to make him wholly mine.
Because you never wanted him.
You're wrong, I did want him. But someone stood between us from the first.
You mean I stood between you?
Oh, no, not in the beginning.
Well, who then?
His aunt.
Asta?
Yes. Asta stood like a wall between Eyolf and me.
You felt that?
Yes. Asta made him hers. Right from the time it happened. The accident.
Well, if she did, she did it out of love.
Exactly. And I'm not prepared to share with anyone, not in love.
Well, you and I ought to have shared him in love.
If it comes to that, you never loved him either.
I never loved him.
Yeah. You're only ever in love with your book about responsibility.
I was preoccupied with that, it is true, but I gave it up for Eyolf's sake.
But not because you loved him.
What do you mean?
You gave it up because you were eaten up with self-distrust. You'd begun to doubt whether you had any great calling to live for after all.
Did I give you cause to think that?
Oh, yes, in small things. And then you needed something new. I dare say I wasn't enough for you any longer.
It is the law of change, Rita.
That was why you wanted to make poor little Eyolf into a child prodigy.
That's not true. I wanted him to be happy, that's all.
But not because you loved him. Look into yourself. And think of all you have buried there. And would like to forget.
You're trying to avoid the issue.
So are you.
If you're right in what you're thinking, our child never really belonged to us.
No. We never loved him.
And yet we sit here bitterly mourning his loss.
Yes. Isn't it odd that we are sitting here mourning a little stranger boy?
Rita, for God's sake, don't call him a stranger.
We never won his love, Alfred, neither you nor I.
And now it is too late. It's too late. And it is you who are guilty.
I?
Yes, you. It's your fault that he became what he was. It's your fault that he couldn't save himself when he fell into the water.
Alfred, don't blame me for that.
I do, and you know it's true. Because it was you who left that helpless baby unattended on the table.
He lay there so comfortably among the cushions and slept so sweetly, and you promised to keep an eye on
That's
him.
That's right, and then you came and tempted me into you.
Oh, be a man and admit that you forgot the child and everything.
By God, you're right. I forgot the child in your arms.
Alfred, that's vile.
In that moment, you condemned little Eyolf to death.
You too. If I am guilty, so are you.
Oh, very well, we are both guilty. So, there was retribution in Eyolf's death, after all.
Retribution?
Yes, a judgment on you and me. And now we have what we deserve. Because while he lived, our cowardly, furtive consciences would not let us love him because we could not bear to look at the thing he carried.
The crutch.
Yes, that. And what we call our loss, our grief, is merely the gnawing of our consciences, nothing more.
Alfred, this can only lead us into despair, perhaps beyond into madness. We can never undo what has been done.
I dreamed of Eyolf last night. I thought I saw him coming up from the jetty.
He could run like the other boys. Nothing had happened to him, nothing at all. This stifling existence was only a dream, I thought. Oh, Rita, how I praised and thanked.
Whom?
Whom?
Whom did you praise and thank?
I told you I was dreaming.
The one in whom you do not believe.
It just happened that way. I was asleep, I tell you.
You should not have sowed the seeds of doubt in me, Alfred.
Would I have done better to let you continue through life believing in empty illusions?
It would have been better for me. I should at least have been able to turn somewhere for comfort. Now I'm nowhere.
Right, if you were given the choice now, if you could follow Eyolf to where he now is.
Yes.
If you could be sure you would find him again, know him, understand him.
Yes. Yes.
Would you leap the gulf to join him? Leave all this, renounce life. Would you do that, Rita?
You mean now?
Yes, today. Now, answer me, would you?
I don't know. I think I should choose to stay here with you for a while.
For my sake?
Yes, only for your sake.
But afterwards, would you? Answer me.
What can I say? You know I could never leave you. Never.
Suppose I were to go to join Eyolf, and suppose you knew for sure that you would find both him and me there? Then, would you come to join us?
I should like to. With all my heart.
But?
I don't think I could. No. No, I simply couldn't. No, not even for the promise of heaven.
Neither could I.
No, you couldn't do it either, could you, Alfred?
No. Because this is where we belong. Here, on Earth. Living.
Here is the kind of happiness we understand.
Oh. Happiness. Happiness.
You mean we shall never find happiness again? But suppose... No, I don't say it.
Say it, Rita, say it.
Couldn't we try to? If only we could forget.
Forget Eyolf?
No, forget ourselves, our guilt.
Is that what you want?
Yes, if it's possible. I can't stand this much longer, Alfred. Can't we find something to make us forget?
What?
We could travel, go far away.
Go away? You're never happy anywhere but here.
Well, we could invite people here. Keep open house. Throw ourselves into some activity which would deaden...
That kind of life is not for me. No, rather than that, I would try to take up my work again.
Your book? Which has stood for so many years between us?
There will always be something between us now.
Why?
Who knows if huge child eyes don't watch us night and day?
Alfred...
Our love has been a consuming fire. Now it has burned itself out.
Burned out?
It is already burned out in one of us.
And you dare say that to me?
It's dead, Rita. But something has taken its place. A sharing of guilt and remorse, a sharing in which perhaps there is a new beginning, a resurrection.
Resurrection? What do I care for resurrection?
Rita.
I'm flesh and blood. I cannot drowse my life away like a fish. To be walled up for the rest of my life in a cell of guilt and remorse with a man who is no longer mine, mine, mine!
It had to end sometime.
Had it to end like this. A love that began as consumingly as ours did.
My first feeling for you was not love, Rita.
What was it, then?
Fear.
That I can understand. But if that was so, how did I manage to win you?
You were so... so consumingly beautiful, Rita.
Was it only that, Alfred? Answer me, was there nothing else?
Yes, there was something else.
I can guess what it was. My gold and my green forests, I think you called them, aren't I right, Alfred?
Yes.
How could you? How could you do it?
I had Aster to think of.
Ah, yes! Aster.
So it was Asta who brought us together.
She knows nothing. She has no inkling of it even now.
Nonetheless, it was Asta. No. It was little Eyolf. Yes, Alfred. Little Eyolf.
Eyolf?
You used to call her your little Eyolf, didn't you? I seem to remember you telling me once, in a secret moment. Do you remember that terrifyingly beautiful moment, Alfred?
I remember nothing. I don't want to remember.
It was the moment when your other little Eyolf became a cripple.
The retribution.
Yes. The retribution. Well, Asta, have you and Mr. Borgheim said all you had to say to each other?
Yes, I think so.
Miss Almas has been very quiet during our walk.
Really? Alfred and I have said enough to each other.
Yes?
To last us for the rest of our lives. Come now, let us go up to the house. Alfred and I need company from now on. We two can't be alone now.
You two go ahead, Asta. I must have a word with you.
Indeed. Well, come with me then, Mr. Borgheim.
Alfred, what has been happening?
I can't stand it here any longer.
Here? You mean with Rita?
Yes, Rita and I cannot go on living together.
Alfred, you mustn't say such dreadful things.
It's true. Living together makes us evil and cruel.
I've never realized.
Nor had I until today.
And now you want... Yes. What do you want, Alfred?
To get away from this place! Far away from it all!
And live on your own?
Yes, as I used to.
Alfred, you can't live alone.
Well, I did once.
You mean in the old days, but then you had me with you.
Yes, and I want to come home to you again, Asta.
To me? No, Alfred, that's quite impossible.
Because of Borgheim?
No, you're wrong. It's not because of him.
Well, I'm glad. Then I return to you, my dear. Dearest, just I must come home to you to be cleansed and purified for my life for
Alfred,
this.
Alfred, it's the same.
Now I have sinned against her, but not in this. Remember, Asta, don't you remember how our life used to be? Was it not one long ecstasy of dedication?
Yes, but you can't relive the past.
Well, you mean my marriage has unfitted me to that kind of life?
No,
then let
that.
Us live again as we used to.
No, Alfred, we cannot.
We can! Love between brother and sister is the one relationship which does not obey the law of change.
But if that should turn out not to be our relationship...
Not what you mean?
My mother's letters. The ones in the portfolio.
Well, what about them?
Read them and have gone.
Why?
Well, you'll find that...
Well, what?
That I have no right to bear your father's name.
Asta?
Read them. Then you'll see. And understand. And perhaps be able to forgive. My mother, too.
I don't understand. I can't credit it. Asta, you mean...
You are not my brother, Alfred.
What difference does that make? None at all.
It changes everything. Our relationship is no longer that of brother and sister.
It is still sacred. It will always remain sacred.
Now it must obey the law of change.
What do you mean?
Don't say... Oh, dearest. My Do you see these water letters?
Did you find anything of interest in them?
One always finds something of interest in old letters. The ones in the portfolio are my mother's.
Yes, well, you must keep them, of course.
No, Alfred, I'd like you to look through them too, sometime later. I haven't brought the key of the portfolio with me today.
Yes, never mind, my dear. I shan't want to read your mother's letters.
One quiet evening, I will tell you something they contain.
Yes, I'll do that, but you keep your mother's letters. You haven't so many reminders of her.
Oh, that horrible old woman. She's brought the smell of death into the house.
Yes, she was rather horrible, wasn't she?
She felt quite ill while she was in the room.
You know, I can understand that power of compelling and drawing things that she spoke of. Being alone in the mountains up on those huge open spaces, one feels that power.
What's happened to you, Alfred?
Happened?
Yes, something's happened. You've changed. Rita knows it too.
Yes, I knew it once. But that's good, isn't it, Alfred?
Well, I hope so. Something good must come from it.
Something happened to you while you were away. Don't deny it. I can see it.
Well, nothing happened to me, but...
What?
In me something happened, a kind of transformation.
Oh, God.
Only for the better, Rita, dear. Believe me.
Now, you must tell us all about it. Absolutely everything.
Yes. Well, let's sit down. And I'll try to tell you as well as I can.
Well?
When I look back on my life, the road I have taken these past 10 years, it seems almost like a fairy tale or a dream. Don't you think so, Aster?
Yes, I think so in many ways.
When I think what we were, Aster, two orphans without a penny.
Oh, that was so long ago.
Now I sit here comfortable, prosperous, able to follow my calling, to work and study just as I please. And all this unbelievable, unlooked-for happiness we owe to you, my dearest Rita.
Now, that's enough of that silly talk.
Yes, well, I mentioned this only as a kind of preamble.
Well, let's take it as read.
Rita, don't think it was the doctor's advice that drove me up to the mountains.
Not the doctor.
What was it, then?
I couldn't find peace to write anymore.
No peace? But, my dear, who disturbed you?
Oh, no one disturbed me. I just came to feel that I was really misusing my... neglecting my true gifts. That I was wasting time.
In writing?
Well, don't you see, I wasn't put here just to write. There must be something I can do as well.
And that was what you were brooding over?
Yes, mostly.
So that's why you've been so discontented with yourself these last months and with us too. Oh, yes, you were, Alfred.
I sat there, bent over my desk, writing day after day, nights as well, writing and writing my... great thick book on the responsibility of man.
But, my dear, that book is your life's work.
Yes, you've told us so often enough.
It was going to be, or so I thought, from the time I grew up, and then you made it possible for me to devote myself to it, my dearest Rita.
What nonsense you talk.
You with your gold and your green forest.
Oh, if you go on talking like that, I shall smack you.
But the book, Alfred.
Somehow it began to seem less and less important, and the claim of higher duties began to fill my mind.
Alfred.
I'm thinking of Eyolf, my dear.
Oh, Eyolf.
He's always in my mind since that tragic fall from the table, and especially now that we know he can never be cured.
But you do everything you can for him, Alfred.
As a schoolmaster, perhaps, but not as a father. From now on, I want to be a father to Eyolf.
I don't think I quite understand you.
I mean, I want to do everything in my power to help him to come to terms with the irrevocable and live with it.
But, Alfred, thank God, I don't think Eyolf feels so deeply about it.
Yes, Rita, he does.
Yes, my dear, you may be sure he feels it deeply.
But, Alfred, what more can you do for him?
I want to try to reveal the potential of the dreams which are dawning in his childish mind and to nurture those high hopes so that they flower and come to fruition. And I want to do more than that. I want to help him to shape his ambitions towards goals that lie within his reach. Because as he is now, he longs only for the things he can never attain. And I want to put happiness within his grasp.
Shouldn't you take these things more calmly, Alfred?
Eyolf shall take up my life's work, if he so wishes. Or perhaps he may choose to attempt something which shall be completely and entirely his. Perhaps that would be best. In any case, I shall write no more.
But, Alfred, dearest, couldn't you work both for yourself and for Eyolf?
No, impossible. In this matter, I cannot divide myself. Therefore, I prefer to yield. Eyolf shall be the one of our family to fulfill himself, and it shall be my task to bring him to self-fulfillment.
It has been a hard struggle for you, Alfred, to come to this decision.
It has. You see, here at home, I could never hope to conquer myself. I've never been able to force myself to renounce anything. Not in this house.
Was that why you went away this summer?
Yes! I climbed up into an infinite solitude. I saw the sun rise above the mountaintops, and I felt nearer the stars, almost as if I understood them and belonged with them. And then I was able to do it.
But will you never carry on with the responsibility of man?
No, never. I've told you, I cannot divide myself between two tasks. I shall fulfill my ideal of human responsibility through my own life.
Do you really believe you'll be able to stay faithful to such high ideals in this house?
With your help, Rita, and with yours, Asta.
And you can divide yourself after all.
My dearest Rita.
Good morning, Mrs. Almers. Well, well, what's this? Home again already, Mr. Almers?
I came back last night.
Uh-huh. His leave was up, Mr. Borgheim.
She's joking.
Joking? It's the truth. His leave had expired.
You keep your husband on a tight rein, Mrs. Almers.
I insist on my rights. In any case, everything has to come to an end sometime.
Oh, not everything, I hope. Good morning, Miss Almers.
Good morning.
Not everything, did you say?
I do believe there is at least one thing in this world which need not come to an end.
I see. You're thinking of love and that kind of thing.
I'm thinking of all that is lovely and unforgettable.
And that will never end. Yes, let's hope so for all our sakes.
You will soon have finished this road you've been building up here.
I have finished it. Yesterday. It's taken a long time. Thank heavens that came to an end.
And that's why you're so cock-a-hoop this morning.
Yes.
Well, I must say.
What, Mrs. Almers?
That's not very nice of you, Mr. Borgheim.
Why not?
Well, it means you won't be seeing very much more of us.
Now, that's true. I hadn't thought of that.
Still, I suppose you'll be able to visit us now and then.
No, no, that won't be possible for a long time. I've just been given an important new contract, which I had to start work on at once.
Have you? I'm delighted to hear it.
Congratulations, Mr. Borgheim. Congratulations.
I'm not meant to be talking about it yet, but I can't keep to myself. It's a big road that's to be built up in the north. There's mountains to negotiate and extraordinary obstacles to overcome. It's a marvelous life to build new roads.
And is it just this new road that brings you here in such high spirits?
No, not only that. The whole future seems so full of hope and promise.
Perhaps there's something even more marvelous lying ahead.
Well, who knows? When fortune comes, she comes like the spring floods. Miss Almers, shall we two take a little stroll together as usual?
No. No, thank you. Not now. Not today.
Please, just for a few minutes. There are so many things I want to say to you before I go.
Something else you mustn't talk about yet, perhaps?
I.
Well, things that cannot be talked about may sometimes be whispered, though with your master.
But Rita...
Miss Astor, remember this will be our last walk together.
Well, let us take a short stroll in the garden, then.
Thank you. Thank you.
You might keep an eye on Eyolf while you're down there.
Eyolf? Why? Yes, where is Eyolf today? I brought something for him.
He's playing down there, Summer.
Really? So he's started to play now. He usually just sits indoors, reading.
I'm going to change all that now. I want him to spend a lot of time out of doors.
Quite right. Let him have his share of the free air, too, poor little fellow. Good God, the best thing we can do in this blessed world is to play. I sometimes think our whole life is a game. Come, Zasta.
Rita, Do you think there's anything between those two?
I don't know what to think.
I used to believe there was, but Asta's been behaving so strangely these last weeks. Almost as though she'd become a stranger to me.
Well, while I've been away, you mean?
Yes, these last weeks.
You don't think she's really interested in him?
Not seriously. Not with her heart and soul. Ruthlessly. No, I don't think she's seriously interested in him now. Would it upset you if she was?
Not upset me, exactly. I can't deny that it would worry me a little, though.
Worry you?
But remember, I'm responsible for Asta and for her happiness.
Nonsense. Responsible. Asta isn't a child. She's old enough to know whom to choose for herself, I should have thought.
Let us hope she is, Rita.
I see no harm in Borgheim.
No, my dear, neither do I. Rather the reverse.
And I should be very happy to see him and Asta married.
Would you? Why?
Because she'd have to go far away with him. And then she could never come and visit us again.
Do you mean you want to be rid of Asta?
Yes, Alfred. Yes.
Why?
Yes. Because then I would have you to myself at last. No, not even then. Not to myself. Oh, Alfred, Alfred, I can't let you go.
Please, mind it, be reasonable.
No, I don't want to be reasonable. I only want you, nothing else in all the world. You.
Now let go of me, you're strangling.
Oh, I wish I could. Oh, when you knew how I've hated you.
Hated me?
Yes, when you sat alone in there, brooding over your work deep into the night. So long, Alfred, and so late. Oh, how I've hated that work of yours.
Well, now I've finished with it.
Yes. And now you're preoccupied with something even more hateful.
Hateful. You call our child hateful.
I do. For what he's done to us. Your book had no face, no voice, but this child is a living wall between us. I won't stand for it, Alfred. I tell you, I won't stand for it.
Sometimes you almost frighten me, Rita.
Sometimes I frighten myself. Don't rouse this demon in me, Alfred.
In heaven's name, do I do that?
Yes. When you destroy what is most sacred between us.
Rita, be reasonable. It's your child, our only child we're talking about.
The child is only half mine. But you shall be mine. All mine. Only mine. I demand it. It's my right.
My dear Rita, it's no use demanding. These things can only be given freely.
And from now on, you are unable to do that.
Yes, from now on, I must divide myself between Eyolf and you.
But if Eyolf had never been born?
Well, that would have been different. Then I would have had only you to love.
And I wish to God I'd never born him.
Rita, you don't know what you're saying.
I gave birth to him in unimaginable pain, but I enjoyed it gladly for your sake.
Yes, I know you did.
But that's over and done with. I want to live with you. Just you and I. I can't be just a mother, Eyolf's mother, and nothing else. I cannot, I tell you, I will not. I want to be everything to you. To you, Alfred.
But you are, Rita, through our child.
Oh, sickening, stale phrases. That's not for me. I was made to bear your child, but not to act the mother to it. You must take me as I am, Alfred.
You were always so fond of Eyolf.
I pitied him, because you gave him no love or kindness. Made him read until his eyes ached. Hardly spent an hour with him.
Yes, I was blind. I had not yet come to realize
but now
that.
You have.
Yes, at last. Now I see that the highest duty open to me in this world is to be a true father to Eyolf.
And to me? What are you going to be to me?
I shall go on loving you, Rita, with all my soul.
I'm not interested in your soul. I want you, all of you, to myself. The way it used to be in those first few unforgettable years. I will never let myself be fobbed off with scraps of love.
But surely there is enough happiness to share between the three of us.
And you can't want much.
Oh.
Listen.
What was it?
When I got your telegram last night.
Yes.
I dressed in white.
Yes, I noticed you were wearing white when I arrived.
I let down my hair.
Yes, it smells so sweetly.
So that it streamed down over my back and shoulders.
I know, Rita, you were so beautiful.
I put rose-colored shades over both laps. We were quite alone, just you and I, awake in the whole house. And there was champagne on the table.
I didn't have any.
True, you didn't. The champagne stood there. But who raised his glass? As the poet said.
I was full of serious thoughts. I was determined to speak to you about our future, and above all, about Eyolf.
And so you did.
No, I wasn't able to. You started to undress yourself.
Yes. And while I undressed myself, you talked to me about Eyolf. Remember, you asked me how little Eyolf's stomach was?
Rita.
And then you lay down in your bed and slept like a child.
Rita.
Alfred.
Yes.
The champagne stood there. But who raised his glass?
I left it untouched. God.
But let me tell you something, Alfred.
What?
Don't be too sure of yourself.
Sure of myself?
You take things too much for granted. You're too sure that you have me.
I don't know what you mean.
I've never been unfaithful to you, Alfred, even in my thoughts, not for a moment.
I know, Rita, I know you so well.
But if you should ever turn your back on me...
Turn my back on you? I don't understand what you mean.
You don't know what I might do if...
If?
If I should ever really believe that you no longer cared for me. Loved me as you used to do.
My dearest Rita, people change with the years. It must happen to us also. It does to everyone.
Not to me. And I won't have any change in you either. I couldn't stand it. I want to keep you all to myself.
Your jealousy is terrible.
I can't change. I am what I am. If you should divide yourself between me and anyone else...
Well, what?
I would have my revenge on you, Alfred.
How would you have your revenge on me?
I don't know. Yes, I do know.
How?
I would throw myself into the arms of the first man who came along.
Ah, that you could never do, my proud, faithful Rita.
Oh, you don't know what I might do.
if you ever stopped loving me.
If I stopped loving you, how can you say such a thing?
I could, for example, spread my nets for that builder of roads who was walking in our garden.
Thank heavens, I thought for a moment you were being serious.
So I am. Why not him as well as the next man?
Well, besides, he's already...
So much the better if I took him from someone else. That's exactly what Eyolf has done to me.
Now, how can you say that Eyolf has done that?
You see. As soon as you even mention Eyolf's name, your voice becomes soft and trembles. Oh, I'm almost tempted to wish that... Oh, well.
Well, what would you wish, Rita?
No. No, I won't tell you ever.
Rita, I beg you, for both our sakes, do not let yourself be tempted to anything that is evil.
Well, Miss Almers and I have taken our last walk together.
You won't be taking a longer journey?
I shall, yes.
Alone?
Yes, alone.
You hear that, Alfred? I wouldn't mind betting some evil eye has played you a trick here.
Evil eye?
Yes.
You believe in the evil eye, Mrs. Harmer?
I'm beginning to. Or anyway, the evil that lies in a child's eye.
How can you?
It is you who are making me like this, Alfred.
What's that noise?
People running out in the jetty.
What is it? Those gutter snipes up to something again, I suppose?
Hey, you boys! What's going on down there?
What are they saying?
They say a child's been drowned.
Oh.
A child drowned?
A little boy, they say.
They can all swim, can't they?
Where's Eyolf?
Don't worry, he's playing in the garden.
No, he wasn't when you were there.
Whose child is it, did you say?
It isn't Eyolf. It isn't Eyolf.
Shh, be quiet. Let me hear what they're saying.
What did they say?
They said the Grouch is floating.
No.
Eyolf. Oh, God. They must save him.
They must. So precious a life. So precious a life.
You oughtn't to sit here in this grey weather, Alfred. I've been looking for you for such a long time.
Thank you.
You've been sitting here long? The whole time?
No. I don't understand it. Seems so impossible, all this. Has it really happened, Asta? What am I dreaming? Have I gone mad? Oh, if only it were a dream. How beautiful if I could wake up now.
Wish I had the power to wake you.
How merciless the fjord looks today. Lying there so heavy, drowsy, lead grey with flashes of yellow reflecting the rain clouds.
Alfred, you mustn't sit here staring at the fjord.
On the surface, yes, but deep down there is the undertow.
For God's sake, don't think of that.
Oh, you think he lies out here, don't you, Aster? But he doesn't. You needn't fear that. Remember how strong the current is here.
It's out to the open sea.
God.
That is why little Eyolf has been taken so far. Far away from us now.
Don't talk like that, Alfred.
You can work it out. You're so clever with figures. 28 hours. No, 29 hours. Let me see.
Alfred.
Can you see the meaning of it?
Of what?
Of what has been done to me and Rita.
The meaning of it?
Yes, the meaning. There must be some meaning in it. Life, creation, providence. Have they no meaning, no purpose at all?
Well, Alfred, how can we tell the purpose of these things?
No, indeed. Perhaps it is all haphazard, and things take their own course, like a wrecked ship drifting. Perhaps that's how it is. It seems so, anyway.
What if it only seems?
Oh, perhaps you can give me a better answer. As for my part, I see none. Here was Eyolf standing on the threshold of discovering life, potent with promise, such rich promise. He was to fill my life with pride and joy, and then it only needs a crazy old hag to come to the house and dangle a dog in a sack.
But, Alfred, we don't know for certain how it happened.
Oh, yes, we know. The boys saw her row out over the fjord, and they saw Eyolf standing alone on the end of the jetty, staring after her. And suddenly he seemed to become giddy, and then he fell and disappeared.
I know.
She dragged him down into the deep, I'm sure of it.
My dear, why should she?
Exactly, why should she? That it can't be retribution. There is nothing to atone for. Eyolf never did any harm, never shouted abuse at her, never threw a stone at a dog. He'd never set eyes on her or the dog before yesterday. So, it can't be retribution. How meaningless it is. How absolutely meaningless, Asta. And yet, it seems to serve the purposes of Providence.
Have you talked about this with Rita?
No, I seem to find it easier to talk to you about it than about everything else. What's that you have there?
Only some crepe.
Yeah. Is it necessary?
Rita asked me to do it. May I?
By all means. Where is Rita?
Out in the garden, I believe. Borgheim is with her.
Oh, is Borgheim out here today?
Yes, he came by the noon train.
I didn't expect him to take the trouble.
He was very fond of Eyolf.
Well, Borgheim is good and loyal.
Yes. You're right, he is loyal.
You're fond of him, aren't you?
Yes, I'm fond of him.
Yet you can't quite make up your mind to...
Oh, Alfred, don't let's talk about it.
Very well. I mean, can you tell me why...
No, please. Don't ask me. It's too distressing for me to talk about. Here. Your hat's ready.
Thank you.
Now, give me your left arm.
Do you want to put crepe on that, too?
It's usual.
As you wish.
Keep your arm still, otherwise I shall prick you.
This is like old times.
Yes, isn't it?
You used to sit like this, mending my clothes when you were a little girl.
I wasn't very good at it.
I remember the first thing you ever sewed for me was a piece of black crepe.
Oh?
Yes, on my student cap when Father died.
Really? I didn't remember.
And, no, of course not. You were only a child then.
Yes.
Then 2 years later, when your mother died, you sewed a big black band on my arm.
I thought you ought to have one.
Yeah, yes, quite right. And then afterwards, when we two were left alone in the world, you finished already?
Yes. Turned out to be a happy time for us after all, Alfred. Just the two of us.
Yes, it did. It was a hard struggle, though. It
was for you.
It was a struggle for you too, Asta. Dear, faithful Eyolf.
Don't remind me of that nonsense.
If you'd been a boy, you would have been called Eyolf.
If? Yes. But then when you went to the university, to think you could have been so childish.
I was childish?
Yes. Now I look back on it. You were ashamed of not having any brother, only a sister.
No, it was you who were ashamed.
Perhaps a little. I felt, I don't know, somehow sorry for you.
You must have done. You got out all the old clothes I'd worn as a boy.
Your best Sunday clothes. Do you remember that blue blouse and the knee breeches?
How well I remember how you looked when you put them on and walked round in them.
I only did it when we were alone at home together.
How solemn we were and how seriously we took ourselves. And I would always call you Eyolf.
Alfred, you haven't said anything about this to Rita, have you?
Yes, I believe I mentioned it to her once, yes.
Alfred, how could you?
Well, you know how it is. One tells one's wife everything, practically everything.
I suppose one does.
Good God, how can I sit here and...
What is it?
I almost forgot him. I forgot him completely.
Eyolf?
Yes, I was sitting here, absorbed in my memories, and he wasn't there.
No, Alfred, you're wrong. Little Eyolf was there in everything we said.
He was not! He slipped right out of my mind, out of my thoughts. I didn't see him for a moment while we were talking. All that while, I forgot him completely.
You must have some rest from your grief.
No, that's something I cannot have. I have no right to it, and I have no heart for it either. There is no place for me but the place where he lies, drifting down there in the dark.
Alfred. Alfred, don't go near the fjord.
Let go of me, Asta! Please, let me get to the boat.
No, Alfred. No, don't go near.
No. No, I won't. Please, just leave me alone.
You must let your mind rest. Come sit down with me again.
Very well. As you wish, Esther.
No, not there.
Yes, let me sit here.
No, when you sit there, you look over... Like that. No. That's better, isn't it?
Hmm.
Now let's go on with what we were talking about before.
Yeah. It was good to forget these sorrows for a moment.
You must forget, Alfred.
But don't you think me weak and unfeeling to be able to do so?
No. One cannot circle round the same thought forever.
Well, I can't anyway. Before you came down to me just now, I was sitting here, tormented by this haunting, gnawing grief, and can you believe it, Asta?
What?
In my agony, I suddenly found myself wondering what there was going to be for dinner today.
As long as it gave you some comfort.
Comfort, yes. That is what I seem to find. What a blessing I have you, Asta. It gives me such joy. Joy in my sorrow.
Your greatest joy should be Rita.
Yes, of course, but Rita is not of my blood. It's not the same as having a sister.
Is that how you feel, Alfred?
Hmm? Yes, well, our family is something apart. Our Christian names always began with a vowel, and do you remember how we used to talk about it? And all our relations are equally poor, and we all have the same eyes.
But
and,
I...
Ah, Asta, you are not... You are your mother's child. You don't really look like one of us, not even like father. And yet...
Yet?
I was thinking that our life together has somehow made you and me resemble each other. Mentally, I mean.
No, Alfred, you're wrong. Hmm? It's I who've grown to resemble you.
Oh.
I owe everything to you, everything I value in the whole world.
You owe me nothing, Asta. On the contrary.
Yes, Alfred, I owe everything to you. You should know that. No sacrifice has been too great.
Sacrifice? What nonsense you talk, Asta. I have simply loved you ever since you were a small child. Besides, I always felt there was so much I had to make amends for. Not so much for what I had done as for father.
Father? What do you mean?
Very well. Father was never very kind to you.
You mustn't say that.
But it's true. He never loved you as he should have done.
Perhaps not as much as he loved you, but that was only to be expected.
No, he was often unkind to your mother, too, during their last years together.
You must remember, Mother was so very much younger than he.
Hmm. Do you think they weren't suited to each other?
I think perhaps not.
And yet Father was always so kind and generous to everyone else.
Mother was not always as she should have been.
Your mother?
Perhaps not always.
To Father?
Yes.
I never noticed anything.
Oh, Alfred, let the dead rest in peace.
Yes, let them rest. But the dead will not give us peace. Day and night they haunt us.
It will seem less painful as time goes by.
It must, mustn't it? Though how I shall survive these first ghastly days, I cannot imagine.
Go up to Rita.
Now, don't ask me to do that. I can't. Don't you understand? I can't. Please, let me stay here with you.
All right. I won't leave you.
Thank you. Where is my little Eyolf now? Can you answer me that, my big, wise Eyolf? No one in the whole world can tell me that. I know only the one dreadful certainty, that I no longer have him.
They're coming now.
How are you, Rita?
Need you ask?
Why have you come down here?
Only to look for you. What are you doing?
Nothing. Asta came down to sit with me.
Yes, but what were you doing before Asta came? You've been away from me the whole morning.
I've been sitting here, looking out over the water.
How can you?
I prefer to be alone now.
Sitting in the same spot like a statue.
I have no reason to go anywhere.
I can't bear it anywhere, least of all here with the fjord lapping one's feet.
Well, that's why I sit here, because it is so near the fjord.
Don't you think he should come up with the rest of us?
I think it would be better for you if you...
No, leave me where I am.
In that case, I shall stay with you.
As you please. Asta, you stay too.
Let us leave them alone together.
Miss Holmes, shall we stroll along the shore together for the very last time?
Yes.
Good morning, Rita, my dear.
Why, Asta? Fancy seeing you here so early.
What brings you all this way from town? I felt so restless. I felt I had to come out and see Eyolf today. Little Eyolf. And you, Rita. So I caught the steamer, and here I am.
And quite by accident, you happened to meet someone you knew. A friend on board?
No, as a matter of fact, I didn't. Why, Rita, what's that?
Alfred's portmanteau. Don't you recognize it?
You mean Alfred's come home?
Yes, would you believe it? He arrived quite unexpectedly by the night train.
So that was it. That was what brought me here. And he hadn't written to say he was coming. Not a postcard.
Not a word.
Not even a telegram.
Yes, it arrived an hour before he did. Short and to the point. Isn't that just like him, Master?
Yes, that's his way. He always was secretive.
Well, it makes it all the more wonderful to have him home again.
And how you feel?
A whole fortnight before I was expecting him.
And he's well and happy, not depressed.
He looked quite transformed as he came in through the door.
He must have been tired, surely.
Tired? He was ready to drop, poor darling. He'd come most of the way on foot.
That mountain air must have been too sharp for him.
I don't know. I haven't heard him cough once since he got back.
Well, there you are. The doctor was right, after all, to advise him to go on that walking tour.
Yes, I suppose so, but you don't know what a dreadful time this has been for me, Asta. I haven't been able to bring myself to talk about it, and you've hardly ever been out to see me.
I should have come more often.
But no. You had your schoolwork to attend to in town, I know. And our pioneer, our builder of roads... He's been away too, hasn't he?
Oh, stop it, Rita.
Very well. The pioneer is dismissed. Oh, but Asta. How I've missed Alfred. How empty it's been. How desolate. Just as though someone had died here.
Rita, he's only been away 6 or 7 weeks.
Oh, but you must remember that Alfred has never been away from me before. Not even for a day. Not in all the 10 years.
But Rita, that's just why I thought it was time he got away this year. He ought to have gone walking in the mountains every summer. That's what he ought to have done.
Oh, it's easy for you to talk. If I were as sensible as you are, I would have let him go before now. Perhaps I couldn't, Astor, I couldn't. I felt somehow that if I once let him go, I might never get him back again. You can understand that, can't you?
No. But then I don't have anyone I'm afraid of losing.
Really? No one at all?
Not that I know of. But tell me, Rita, where is Alfred? Asleep?
Asleep? Not he. He got up this morning just as early as ever.
He can't have been all that tired then.
He was when he arrived last night. But now he's been in with Eyolf for, at least an hour.
Poor pale little child. Is he going to be made to study all day again?
Well, you know Alfred wants it that way.
Yes, Rita, but I think you ought to try and stop him.
Well, really, I can't be expected to interfere in these things. Alfred is better qualified to understand these matters than I am. What else will you have Eyolf do? He can't run about and play like the other children.
I shall speak to Alfred about it.
Yes, my dear, you do that. Ah, here they are.
Astor! Ha! Astor, my dear! Are you out here? It's good to see you. So soon.
I felt I had to. Welcome home.
Thank you.
Doesn't he look splendid?
Wonderful. Wonderful. Your eyes so sparkly. You must have done a lot of writing while you've been away. Have you finished the book?
The book? Oh, that.
I thought it would go easily once you could get away and be alone.
Yes, I used to think so too, but it didn't turn out that way. If I must confess the truth, I haven't written a line.
You haven't written?
Oh, so that's why I found all those blank sheets of paper in your bag.
Well, my dear Alfred, what on earth have you been doing all this time?
Walking and thinking, thinking, thinking.
Thinking a little of us too, I hope.
Yes, of course, a lot, every day.
Well then, everything is as it should be.
But did you really do no work at all on the book? You look so happy and contented. We don't often see you like that. I mean, when your work's not going well.
Yes, I know. I've been so stupid. Thinking is what matters. What one can manage to put down on paper is insignificant.
Insignificant?
Have you gone mad, Alfred?
No, Father. What you write is important.
Yes, my son, if you say so, but I tell you, there is one who will come after me who will do these things better.
Who will that be? Oh, tell me.
Give him time. He will show himself.
But what will you do when he comes?
I shall return to the mountains.
Oh, shame on you, Alfred.
To the high peaks and the great wide spaces.
Don't you think I shall soon be well enough to come with you?
Perhaps, perhaps, my boy.
I think it would be nice if I too could climb mountains.
How smart you look today, Eyolf.
You think so, Aunt?
Yes. Is it for your father's sake you put your new clothes on?
Yes. I asked Mother to let me. I wanted Father to see me in them.
You shouldn't have given him that kind of suit.
But he begged me so again and again. He gave me no peace.
Father, Borkheim has given me a bow. Isn't it wonderful? And he's taught me to shoot with it.
Yeah, that really is a good idea, Eyolf.
Next time he comes, I'm going to ask him to teach me to swim, too.
To swim? Why do you want to learn that?
All the other boys can swim. I'm the only one who can't.
Now, you shall learn anything. Anything you want to learn, you shall.
Shall I tell you what I most want to learn, Father?
Mark, tell me.
Most of all, I should like to be a soldier.
Little Eyolf, there are so many other things better than that.
Yes, but when I grow big, I must be a soldier. You know that.
Yes, we'll see. We'll see.
Eyolf, come over here. I have something to tell you.
What is it, Aunt?
What do you think? I have seen the rat wife.
What? You've seen the rat wife? Oh, no, it isn't true.
Yes, it is. I saw her yesterday.
Where did you see her?
On the road outside the town.
I saw her, too, out in the countryside.
Perhaps we shall see her, too, then, Eyolf.
Aunt, isn't it strange that she should be called the rat wife?
People call her that because she goes round the country and drives away all the rats.
I believe her real name is Mother Lupus.
Lupus. That means wolf, doesn't it?
Oh, what a lot of things you know, Eyolf.
Then perhaps it may be true after all that she turns into a werewolf at night. Do you think it is, Father?
No, I don't think so. Now, why don't you run out and play in the garden?
Oughtn't I to take some of my books with me?
No, no more books from now on. Go on, run down to the shore and play with the other boys.
No, Father. I don't want to play with them today.
Why not?
Because of my clothes.
To
Did they make fun of you, of your fine clothes?
No, they wouldn't dare do that. If they did, I should beat them.
Well, then why?
I don't like them, Father. And they say I can never become a soldier.
Why did they say that?
I think they envy me. They're so poor, Father. They have to go barefoot.
Ah, Rita, how this gnaws at my heart.
Now, now, now.
Those boys shall know one day who is master down there.
Someone's knocking.
Must be Borgheim.
Come in.
Arms, this must be her.
Begging your pardon? Have your honours any troublesome thing that gnaws here in this house?
Have we? No, I don't think so.
Ah. I'd be glad to rid you of it if you had any gnawing thing that troubles you.
We understand, but we have nothing like that in this house.
That's a great pity. For I'm on my rounds, and who knows when I shall pass this way again. Oh, but I'm tired.
Yes. Yes, indeed. You look tired.
Poor little creatures. Everybody hates them. After them the whole time. It oughtn't to be tiring helping them, being kind to them, but it drains the body's strength.
Sit and rest yourself, old woman.
Thanks, gracious lady. 1,000 thanks. The whole night I've been about my business.
Have you? Where?
Over on the islands. The people there sent for me. They didn't want to, but they had no choice. They had to bury their teeth in the sour apple. Sour apple, little master. Sour apple.
Why did they have to?
After what, little master?
Bury their teeth in the sour apple.
Why? Because they couldn't find anything to fill their bellies with. Because of the rats and all the hungry little baby rats. You understand, young master?
Poor wretched people, were they so plagued by them?
Plagued, thousands of them, swarming, teeming. Up in the beds they crept and crawled the whole night long. They plopped down into the milk churns. Over the floor they hissed and rustled this way, that way.
I never want to go there, aunt.
But then I came. I and another. And we took them all away with us, the sweet small creatures. We made an end of every one of them.
Father, look, look!
For God's sake, Eyolf, what's the matter?
Something's struggling in the bank!
Oh! Get rid of her, Alfred. Oh,
dear lady, don't be afraid of such a harmless little creature.
What have you got there?
It's only Mopsy Man. Come up from your darkness, my little Mopsy Man. Don't be afraid of him, my little wounded soldier. Come close and stroke him. He won't bite you. Come and stroke him. Come and stroke him. Come and stroke him.
No, I daren't.
Doesn't the young master think Mopsy Man has a lovely, gentle face?
Him?
Yes, dearie, him.
I think his most horrible face I've ever seen.
Well, you'll change your mind. You'll change your mind.
And at the same time, he's beautiful. Beautiful.
Just now, he's so tired and full of aches and pains, poor little creature. It drains a body's strength, that game.
What game?
Why, follow my leader.
Oh, so this, is this dog of yours the one who lures and leads them?
Mopsamand and I, we lead them. We work together, he and I. Easiest thing in the world, you think, to watch us. I tie a string to his collar, and then I lead him 3 times round the house. While I do this, I play on my pipe. And when they hear me play, up they have to come from the cellars, down from the lofts, out of all the dark holes and crannies. All of them. Bless their little hearts.
Then he bites them all to death?
No. We just go down to the boat, he and I. And they come after us. All the old ones and their little darlings with them.
And then what happens?
Well, we draw away from the land. I pull at the oars and then I play on my pipe. And Mopsy Man swims behind. And all the little creatures that crept and crawled, they follow us further and further out to the deep waters. They have to.
Why do they have to?
Because they don't want to. Because they're so afraid of the deep water. That's why they have to swim out to it.
And then they drown?
Every single one. And then they have all the dark and peace and quiet they could wish for, the little angels. They sleep so long, so sweet a sleep. All the little creatures that men hate and persecute. In the old days, I needed no Mopsy Man. I could lure them myself. Alone.
What did you lure?
Men. One especially.
Who? Oh, tell me.
Why, my sweetheart. Little ladies' man.
Where is he now?
Down among the rats. Now, I must be about my business again. Are you sure you have no work for me to do? I could get it done at once.
No. No, thank you. I don't think we need your services today.
You don't think so? But you can never be sure. If you should remember anything that nibbles and gnaws, creeps and crawls, just send for me and Mopsy Man. Fare ye well.
And now I've seen the rat wife too.
Isn't this your portfolio, Master?
Yes. It's got some of those old letters in it.
Oh, the family letters.
Don't you remember? You asked me to go through them while you were away.
Did you really manage to find the time?
Yes, I did some of it here and some at home in town.
Thank you.